26th consecutive season, the folks in Lincoln, Nebraska either sit around their television or come to Memorial Stadium as a tradition, because the day after Thanksgiving belongs to Husker Red, and today is no different. As one of their rivals comes into town, the Iowa Hawkeyes, which have an unblemished record at 11-0, a number 4 ranking next to their name, as they come into Memorial Stadium trying to avoid the upset. ESPN College Football on ABC is presented by K Jewelers, all part of ESPN's Rivalry Series presented by Jiffy Lube. Iowa, with an eye towards the college football playoff and a date of the Big Ten championship game next week, the Big Ten West champs try to avoid the upset against the Huskers today. A few key wins during this 11-0 run for the Iowa Hawkeyes, certainly some things that they can hang their hat on in terms of a resume. Late game-winning field goal against an 8-win Pittsburgh team earlier this season, 57-yarder from Marshall Kane. They go on the road against a top 20 Wisconsin team. Their defense was stout. They held the Badgers to 6 points in a win. And then against a top 20 team on the road in Northwestern, they run all over them, put up 40 points. And this has been a very impressive Iowa Hawkeye team as we welcome you to the broadcast booth. Adam Amin, Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan, happy holidays to you and yours. There can be some debate if Iowa loses one of their final two games on whether or not they're a playoff team. But they have no plans on that right now. They want to remove all doubt. Win today, win in Indianapolis, and it'd be a travesty if they got left out of the college football playoff.
I couldn't agree more. And right now, the committee has it exactly right. There is no debate, but they have to win out. I don't like defending a one-loss Iowa team. Undefeated Iowa team, they're in it, no doubt about it.
Now, this is a dangerous game. I know 5-6 for Nebraska doesn't look scary, but this is a scary team. They've had a wild season, a ton of close losses for the Cornhuskers, going all the way back to their opening game when they lost on the final offensive play for BYU, a Hail Mary, to lose their opener at home. They lose to Miami in overtime after coming back from a large deficit. They lose to Illinois on the game's final play for the Illini. They lose on Wisconsin's final offensive play. All these close losses, 5-6, may not scare anybody, but it scared Michigan State. Unbeaten Spartans came in. They were able to get the victory, granted on a bit of a controversial Brandon Riley touchdown. But all that being said, this is a scary Nebraska team. They won 2 weeks ago on the road, and they're coming off a bye week. They're a little healthier as well.
You know, the interesting thing is those early season gut-wrenching losses have really fortified this team, to be honest with you. They've gone through that coaching transition, and right now Nebraska is a scary team. They're playing their best football right now that they have all season long.
And again, this is a rivalry series. It goes all the way back to 1891 was the first time that Iowa and Nebraska actually met on the football field. And this is going to be an incredible atmosphere today as Tommy Armstrong Jr., the quarterback for the Huskers, tries to lead this team to a bowl victory, or victory rather, and a bowl appearance for the 8th consecutive year. Only twice since 1962, when Bob Devaney took over, has Nebraska failed to reach the postseason, and they get set to take the field for the 347th consecutive sellout at Lincoln Memorial Stadium, an NCAA record. Defeated Iowa Hawkeyes, the upset-minded Nebraska Cornhuskers. 124 years of a rivalry continues next. ESPN College Football on ABC presented by K Jewelers. Iowa, Nebraska in our Dr. Pepper Championship Drive game of the week. The Hawkeyes at 11-0, and they will be without one of their key defensive players, at least for a little bit. Olivia Harlan on the field is more.
Adam, we just got confirmation that Iowa cornerback Desmond King will not play the entire first quarter. This is punishment for being late to a team meeting. This illustrates Kirk Ferentz's no-nonsense approach, too. Now, it's only third quarter, but it could affect what Nebraska is able to do offensively to start the game, because King leads the country in interceptions with 8. I saw him warming up all the same, but you'll have to stay warm till the second quarter. So Maurice Fleming will start at right corner for King, and Sean Draper filling in his place in their nickel package. Now, these two combined for 72 college games, guys. So that's good experience behind them.
And they'll lead least have a little bit of cushion on the back end.
Yeah, what's going to be interesting is I think Seathan Carter, the tight end for Nebraska, is a guy that they've been targeting more in the pass game, and that's exactly the matchup they want. They want to target those nickel defenders and those linebackers.
Saw Kirk Ferentz, Iowa seeking its first 12-win season in program history. Meanwhile, first two-game win streak for Mike Riley and the Huskers in his first season in Lincoln. Nebraska won the toss, and Iowa will get the ball first. Ninth time in 12 games, the Hawkeyes offense will see the field for the first time. And Jonathan Parker from the 8-yard line will take it out across the 30 on a solid return. And that's where the Hawkeye offense, averaging 34 points a game, will set up. Led by the redshirt junior out of Tennessee, C.J. Beathard, the first Iowa quarterback to start his career 12-0. And he's starting to get a little healthier, too. He's been dealing with a groin and hip combination injury.
Yeah, he does a great job at the line of scrimmage, getting his team into plays of an advantage, but his mobility is very important schematically for this Iowa offense.
For the first time, a spot in the Big Ten title game awaits for Iowa, but leave no doubt, says Kirk Ferentz, win out and we're in the college football playoff. Here we go, from the 32-yard line, on first down, a pass to Vandenberg. Matt Vandenberg, Iowa's leading receiver, has a first down and out of bounds near midfield into Nebraska territory to start the day.
And Iowa comes right out, kind of breaking tendency. We hear all about the zone run scheme, and they come out with a quick passing game. And Mark Vandenberg, particularly from the slot position, is a top target.
57 catches for the junior out of South Dakota, Matt Vandenberg, to lead the Iowa Hawkeyes. First down from the 47, and LaShawn Daniels gets the first carry of the game. Grabbed quickly by Nate Geary, Nebraska's leading tackler, after a gain of 3 yards. Let's take a look at our impact players, and Jordan Kanziri is back for the Hawkeyes.
Yeah, Kanziri is probably the most balanced running back that Iowa has, and then Henry Krager Colville is a converting tight end on third down. Nate Geary is experienced at the safety position. Malik Collins typically plays well against Iowa. He's going to have to take away that run today.
Daniels again stacked up after a short gain. Dedrick Young is the first man there, the true freshman linebacker. And it's going to bring up third down, where Iowa has been very good as of late. And really good all season long, converting 47%, 15 for their last 25. And this is where Krager Colville could be a big factor.
And Iowa typically is in third in their advantage. Typically, they don't have to throw the football. Third and six is a different animal, but first and second down success typically puts Iowa in a great position.
Blitz is on for the Huskers. Beathard dumps it off over the middle, and Matt Vandenberg gets stopped by the cornerback, Josh Kalu. Inside the 40-yard line, kind of no man's land right now. What does Iowa do on offense?
I think Iowa's going to punt this away early in this game when it's probably a field position type of game. I think they go ahead and punt this away.
They will be punting into the wind here. The wind is always a factor here at Lincoln Memorial Stadium. And Dylan Kidd, the senior out of Florida, will get set to kick to Jordan Westerkamp. Hoping that that ball dies in the wind, which it does, and it's down at the 5-yard line for Iowa by Joshua Jackson, the freshman. Well-placed 33-yard punt for Dylan Kidd, pinning the Huskers deep and a long field in front of Nebraska's second all-time leading passer in yards and touchdowns in Tommy Armstrong. Only Taylor Martinez has better numbers. And right now, only Connor Cook has as many touchdown passes in the Big Ten as Armstrong this year with 21.
Yeah, and Armstrong also has 12 interceptions, Adam, and that's going to be the key today. It's his decision-making. He's a great on-the-move passer, but it's his decision-making that is going to have to be buttoned up here today against Iowa defensively.
Imani Cross will start the game. Terrell Newby, their leading rusher, has been dealing with a bit of an ankle issue the last couple of games, but he is active. Here is Cross, and he picks up 4 yards to the 9. Take a look at our impact players when Nebraska is on the ball, and note Desmond King on the back end for Iowa as well.
Yeah, Desmond King is very important, obviously, but he's going to be out in this first quarter. Nate Meyer is the pressure guy off the edge. We've already heard of Cross, and he's a bigger back. And then Stephen Carter is going to be big here today. He's a big body tight end matching up on linebackers and safeties.
Top of the formation, it's Maurice Fleming in for Desmond King. Tommy Armstrong keeps the football and dives ahead to set up a makeable third and about 2.5 with Josie Jewell closing in towards the legs.
And so, Adam, what happens is Desmond King is out, so Maurice Fleming flips over to that side in his right corner position, and then Draper has to go into that nickel spot. Typically, Desmond King would slide inside in nickel, and that would be the matchup. It would be Stephen Carter on Desmond King, so look for Nebraska to take advantage of that early in this game.
Top of the formation, that's where Fleming is. A guy who's played in 31 career games. They'll run it with Armstrong hopping towards the line to gain. He got grabbed by Jordan Lomax. Very close to the sticks, and he got to the 15-yard line enough for a first down.
Adam, Nebraska offensively has actually become very similar to Iowa. They're running the football better. Their offensive line is playing better. And this guy right here, Tommy Armstrong, obviously can run the ball. He's great outside the design of the play. Today it's about his decision making.
Almost 1,200 rushing yards in Tommy Armstrong Jr.'s career. Terrell Newby is in. And here is the carry for Newby. And again, dealing with that bum ankle, only 5 combined carries against Michigan State and Rutgers. Picks up a couple of yards there.
And with Newby out, that's where we've seen more of Amani Cross, and it gives a bigger back. Typically, Nebraska, they've been running more 12 personnel, single back, a bigger back in Cross, and 2 tight ends, and their offensive line is playing better. All of that adds up to a more productive run game the last couple of games.
And then coming off that 12th week bye, got a chance to get a little healthier as well and prep for Iowa. Here is Newby. Looks pretty good shifting that time and works out to the 21-yard line, running into Maurice Fleming. 4 more yards on that play. 5 straight runs to open up this game for the Huskers.
And Nebraska really has played their best football the last couple of games against Rutgers, and that upset here in this place against Michigan State. But it was the run game that was the difference. They were able to control it and set up the play-action passing game.
3rd down, 4. Armstrong with that design run got grabbed from behind by Jaleel Johnson. The redshirt junior, who's been a stud inside this season, comes up with a tackle for loss.
Jaleel Johnson, from his tackle position, he's just going to slice inside and beat the offensive lineman right inside early. It was actually Stirrup, 6'8", 320, and Stirrup is in there to bring more physicality to the line of scrimmage, and that time he got beat inside by Johnson.
So Sam Foltz, the Big Ten's top punter, will kick away to Riley McCarron. Again, Desmond King is suspended for the first quarter, so McCarron will handle the punts. And a line drive zips out at the 33-yard line. We'll step aside, opening quarter, both teams empty on the first possessions. Welcome back to ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers as part of ESPN's Rivalry Series, presented by Jiffy Lube. Cold and overcast today in Lincoln. As you get a look at our college football playoff rankings, they're brought to you by Chick-fil-A. This game here, don't forget later on tonight, Baylor will face TCU on ESPN, setting up a huge weekend in the Big Ten and the Big 12 especially. Decide with Oklahoma, Oklahoma State tomorrow night on ABC as well. Ohio State, Michigan, Michigan State, Penn State tomorrow. A lot on the line this weekend, the final weekend of November. And the unbeaten Hawkeyes try to stay in the college football playoff picture, currently the number 14. From the 33, C.J. Beathard. Hit as he throws. A floating pass is ruled incomplete. Nearly picked off by Josh Banderas. Beathard under pressure could not get a clean pocket to throw from.
And Iowa choosing to come out once again, throwing on first down, and then this is just a pocket push. Rushing with 4, and the quarterback pressure came from defensive end Greg McMullen. And it's just a push right there, kind of a bull rush, and finally the pocket collapses. Early pressure is significant for Nebraska.
So here is Jordan Kanziri. Gets his first carry and works his way to the 37-yard line. Kanziri had that big game against Illinois where he ran for 256, then got hurt against Northwestern the week later, missed a couple of games against Maryland and Indiana. He's been back the last two games, and he had a touchdown last week against Purdue. He comes off, and it's third down and six for Iowa. Whistle from the far side of the field. Looks like perhaps Nebraska.
Timeout, Nebraska. Their first timeout on the field.
First timeout from Mike Riley. We'll step aside as well. Jack Anguish, the former walk-on. Just like his dad, Paul, who played for Tom Osborne, one of 18 seniors playing today on Senior Day for Nebraska. ESPN College Football on ABC presented by Kay Jewelers. Part of ESPN's Dr. Pepper Championship Drive Game of the Week. Here in Lincoln, Nebraska, undefeated Iowa has third down on its second offensive series. Four-man twist for Nebraska gets picked up, and a line drive into the chest of Tavon Smith, delivered by Befford, who took a blow after the play, and a penalty marker was thrown as Malik Collins got to him in the backfield.
Holding offense on the 79, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Negates what would have been a 10-yard completion to Smith to move the chains. Instead, Sean Welsh gets tagged for the hold.
And Iowa really isn't built, Adam, to overcome those negatives, especially in their pass game. They're typically be an advantage and throw when we want to, not when we have to type of team. This isn't that case right here.
They have had a lot of explosive plays this year. It's been a balanced offense for Kirk Ferentz's team. They're going to need something big on third and 16 against a Husker defense looking to pin its ears back. Here comes the rush. Befford will try to tuck it and run, and will get shoved out at the 30-yard line. Good pressure from Dedrick Young in the backfield, forcing Befford out, and it's fourth down.
Nebraska brought a little bit of pressure, but they also went man-to-man on the back end with one high safety. That's exactly where the defense has to make sure they have eyes on number 16, C.J. Beathard, because of his increased mobility. He's healthier. He can gash you on plays like that.
Marshall Kane, the normal place kicker, is a rugby-style backup punter to Dylan Kidd. He's out there kicking to Jordan Westerkamp. Have to kick into the wind here, so maybe that's why they want to go rugby style. But that is a shank out of bounds, shy of midfield. And Nebraska is going to have outstanding field position on a rare poor punt by Marshall Kane.
Yeah, Marshall Kane came out there to try to drive one low into the wind, and this just went off his foot to the right from the get-go. He's obviously not very productive.
Yeah, he's been good as a rugby-style kicker, well over 40 yards per punt. But again, was kicking into the wind. They were trying to avoid it. Weather is a factor. Both coaches talked about it. Obviously, Iowa played in bad home field conditions last week at Kinnick with that 8-inch snowfall overnight. But they were able to deal with that in their win against Purdue. Ends up being a 17-yard punt, setting him up at the 47-yard line. And Tommy Armstrong, Jr., zipping one into an Iowa Hawkeye. Another interception for the Hawkeyes, leading the Big Ten, and this time it's Cole Fisher.
Off the play action, Armstrong was booting out to the right, and then it was a throwback on a wheel route that was double covered, and this is simply a very poor decision. I think he rethought the pass when it was too late and the ball went out of his hand, and the mechanics as well. Watch where his left foot is placed. It goes away from the target. He falls away from the target, and the ball is picked off. It was a bad decision, bad mechanics, and Armstrong is going to have to be more buttoned up today if Nebraska's going to have a chance to win this game.
Career high 13th interception for Armstrong this year. Turnover margin has really told the story of these two team seasons. From the 44-yard line, here is LaShawn Daniels trying to squeeze through a hole, and a good play by Ross DeZuris, who has stepped up into a really solid role this year, making the stop. Pickup of about a yard. We talk about turnover margin deciding a lot of games. No shock. Wow. Iowa plus 11, Nebraska minus 11.
Yeah, if Nebraska turns it over, they have absolutely no shot whatsoever, because everything funnels into that place for Iowa. They take it away and they don't give it away.
Beathard to the outside for Henry Krager Kobel, and that snaps a streak of 12 straight receptions that have gone for a touchdown or a first down for the redshirt senior out of Iowa, but good yardage to set up a more makeable third and four.
Yeah, third and four is really a mixed type of down. You can run it on third and four to convert it. You can throw it, and this is typically where Iowa is, and that's why they're converting coming into this game at 47% on third down.
Here comes the blitz. Good blitz pickup on the back end for the Iowa Hawkeyes, but an incompletion looking for Vandenberg. He was tightly covered by Kalu. Vandenberg wanted the flag, but that ball seemed a little bit wayward anyway, and it's fourth down.
It was really good coverage by Kalu, and Vandenberg was coming out of his slot position and running a route where he comes inside and then swirls back out. I think that's very good coverage and a very good no call.
So Kane had a 17-yard punt. Now Kidd is going to come back in, kicking into the wind. Jordan Westerkamp is back to return. Remember, DeMornay Pearson-L, who had an 80-yard punt return for a touchdown last year against Iowa, he injured his knee against Purdue, so he's done for the year. Good hang time on that kick into the wind, and a fair catch at the 20-yard line on a 30-yard punt. 5:24 for the first. The evening after Nebraska defeated Rutgers a couple of weeks ago, there was an investigation of an alleged sexual assault at the residence of Tommy Armstrong and Jordan Westerkamp. Both were questioned by police. No arrests by Lincoln police were made after they stated there were indications that an incident occurred, but not enough evidence to proceed legally. There was an unnamed woman who had identified an attacker, and police had already contacted the suspect, but not enough legal evidence to proceed further with the case, so the Lincoln police shut down the investigation and closed it up. First down for Nebraska, Imani Cross on a short pickup of 2 yards. Armstrong on the previous possession threw an interception. It was a bad one, but something that this coaching staff told us about him is the fact that he is able to bounce back after bad interceptions. He did that against Michigan State, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, a horrendous interception against Michigan State, and then he comes back and has 2 long scoring drives, and one was the game winner. So he has that bounce back ability, but you'd like to see better decision making in the moment.
This is a good to newbie. And Terrell Newby grabbed in the open field by Greg Maben at the 26-yard line, setting up third down and 4 for Nebraska.
Yeah, and we talked about this. Newby has that ankle that he's coming back from, and he's the one that gives a little more shimmy and shake and speed in that run game. And Imani Cross is a bruiser, and what Nebraska started to do when Newby was out, double tights and a big running back, and they started to get something in the box out of their run game.
They'll leave Newby in on third down. Armstrong went into the short side, and a good block on the outside by Newby, diving at the ankles of an Iowa defender, opening things up for an Armstrong first down run of 10.
Very well designed by Nebraska. The fly sweep motion provided the fake that time, and then it was Newby leading Armstrong around the edge. You watch the block right there, and it springs his quarterback to convert and move the chains, which is very, very important against Iowa here today.
So Newby, after the good block, steps out, crosses back in. It's been mostly runs. 9 runs, 1 pass for the Huskers. And continuing that trend, not much there for Cross. As for the first time, we say hello to the OG. John Saunders, what do you got, my friend?
Yes, I am the original guy. It's our Taco Bell update. Western Michigan against Toledo. PJ Fleck has reason to celebrate as they play off the spoiler by kicking Toledo out of the playoff. Northern Illinois and Bowling Green will meet for the championship.
We'll see that in Detroit next weekend, John. Thanks very much. Almost all runs for Nebraska. Second down and 9, and movement before the play for a false start. And Ron Snodgrass has the call.
False start. Offense, number 8, 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
True freshman out of New Orleans, Stanley Morgan, has been a very important factor for this Nebraska team this year. The Huskers, though, especially early in the season, and it has tailed off a little bit, but still one of the more penalized teams in the country.
And the penalties have gone down because I think the understanding schematically on both sides of the ball has gone up, and you would expect the penalties to go down, but that was a bad one there. Second and 9 turns into second and 14.
And now another penalty flag comes flying in as the Hawkeyes begin to show some pressure.
False start. Offense, number 66. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
It's the former walk-on, Dylan Utter, making his 13th career start. They had some turnover on the offensive line from last year's team. That went 9-4. They defeated Iowa in a huge 17-point second-half comeback, a game they won in overtime. Sean Eichhorst, the athletic director, though, still fired Bo Pelini after that game, stating that the Iowa win wasn't good enough to keep Pelini around. Swing it out for Newby, and not much there at all. It's going to set up third down and a country mile for Nebraska. Set it up for a huge weekend in the Big Ten. The game at noon Eastern tomorrow on ABC, and then Penn State, Michigan State on ESPN at 3:30. It's all part of the rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. If Michigan State wins tomorrow, they're into the Big Ten championship game. If they lose, then whoever wins the Ohio State-Michigan game will get into the Big Ten championship game to face Iowa. And it's the first edition of Harbaugh against Meyer. This is Ben Neiman, who's being tended to right now at the end of that play. And he looks very woozy. This is a scary sight right now. I'm certainly not going to speculate as to what might be wrong, but it just looks bad for the sophomore out of Illinois. To the point where the Nebraska staff is over there checking up on how Neiman is doing as well. .44 in white going after Newby here. Oh no, right. Ooh, at the end of that, yeah. Play, Josie Jewell was coming in to help finish off that tackle. And Neiman had a lot of trouble getting up after that play. This is not a good sight.
And Neiman played that exactly right. What you do on that bubble screen is you force everything back inside, and that's where Josie Jewell came from. The middle linebacker supported from inside and got more of Ben Neiman than he did the ball carrier.
Almost looks like he's trying to mouth, I'm fine, but obviously a very scary sight. A young man who's had a really productive year at the outside linebacker spot. Sophomore out of Sycamore, Illinois. And he's going to get help all the way across the field to the Iowa sideline.
And that linebacking level has been instrumental in Iowa's success defensively. Remember that trio in 2013 really had all the pressure numbers for this Iowa team. And then in 2014, those three were gone and the pressure numbers went with them. They rediscovered a lot of that. And Ben Neiman has been right in the middle of that.
You're talking about guys like Christian Kirksey and Anthony Hitchens, a couple of top 4-round draft picks a couple of years ago for Iowa at the linebacking level. So Bo Bauer, who's had a lot of experience and has had some really productive times this season, is going to check in. A redshirt sophomore out of West Branch, Iowa. Honorable mention all-freshman selection last season. Third down and 17 for Nebraska here from the 29. It's the four-man rush for the Hawkeyes. Armstrong throwing for Westerkamp, and had that ball gotten through, it would have been a first down. Instead, Cole Fisher, the Nebraska native, who's got some family who played for the Huskers, comes up with his second big pass defense of this game.
Cole Fisher is the linebacker. Go ahead and let it roll right now, guys. Quarters coverage on the back end, but look at the depth that number 36 Fisher gets. Right there and gets his right hand on it. Right decision by the quarterback Armstrong. Wrong throw. Just put a little more air under that, and that probably gets through to Westerkamp.
There's that line drive rugby-style kick from Fultz. Grabbed by McCarron. And he'll return it across the 30-yard line. Good coverage for Nebraska by Kyron Williams. And down to Olivia Harlan for an update.
Well, guys, you can see C.J. Beathard trying to move a little bit this game. And it's been all week that he's been able to take more reps with the team and scramble out of the pocket. And coaches say this is the first time since his injury, a groin injury, in mid-October that he's really felt full speed again. It will take an off-season surgery and some rehab to really get there. But, guys, he feels as good as he's felt in 5 weeks. He's been really heavy in the film room, too. Coaches say a plus of being a little bit hindered.
Yeah, his understanding of defenses, we were told, has gone up significantly with the extra time in the film room. He sets up at the 34-yard line.
And this is the best part of Beathard's game, at the line of scrimmage, getting in the right play.
May have checked it to the run to the left for Kanziri, and a tackle for loss by Williams. He's been banged up all year. He's gotten awarded a sixth year of eligibility with that hand injury that's hampered him this season.
And Williams starts inside at the defensive tackle position, but the big guy at 300, actually close to 300 pounds, runs down the line, and that's what you need out of this zone blocking scheme with Iowa. You need guys that run with them, get in their hip pocket, and find the ball carrier.
Remember that 22-yard reception by Vandenberg? Only 21 yards since for the Hawkeye offense. Flag thrown as Beathard loses the football. Scooped up by Gary, and the Huskers have it at the 48-yard line. Freedom Akinmolidou knocked it away from Beathard. Gary scooped it. We'll have to check the penalty marker as well. If it's an Iowa penalty, it will likely be declined, and Nebraska will take over with great field position. Iowa's won the turnover battle in every game since game one this season. That's been one of their strengths.
Personal foul. Illegal helmet contact. Hand to the face. Defense. Number 92. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
So Kevin Williams, who just made that great tackle for loss on first down, ends up getting tagged with a penalty that negates a takeaway.
Kevin Williams right in the middle of your screen, and right there you can see the right hand underneath the face mask of the offensive lineman in Welsh. And that was a very good call, and unfortunate because Nebraska took the football away, and quite frankly, they're going to need a short field against this Iowa defense here today.
Think about how many bounces and breaks have not gone Mike Riley's way this season.
He's like, are you kidding me? How many more things can go against us this season? They fought through so much of that, and we're going to have to do it again right here.
A lot of wrinkles, a lot of crow's feet on that 62-year-old face right now, and a lot of it has come from this season.
And if you're wondering, that's not a reviewable situation.
That's correct. Penalty was called on the field. And that was a very clear-cut call against Williams that sets Iowa up at the 49-yard line. First down. Here's Kanziri, and he's got a big hole. He got grabbed by the jersey of the middle linebacker, Chris Weber. Had Weber not grabbed him, he may have burst it open for a score.
And Adam Cox is right here, the fullback. He's going to lead up inside, and then that creates the room right there. Two running back set, lead with the fullback, expand the point of attack, and then Kinsiri has that speed, and that's why I like him as a more balanced running back for Iowa. They can get bigger, but he brings the pack, the total package.
Fifth in the Big Ten in rushing this year, despite missing some time with those ankle issues. Off play action. Throws underneath, and a bouncer for Vandenberg is incomplete. With Byerson Cockrell in coverage, but a couple of penalty markers thrown where Beathard went down to the deck at midfield.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense, number 7, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Iowa's best offense has been Nebraska shooting itself in the foot right now. Malik Collins gets called for this penalty.
And Malik Collins has played well against Iowa, but this is actually about two steps. And Malik Collins feels that he got pushed into the quarterback right there, and I think he might be right. I don't know that that was correctly called on the field. If an offensive lineman pushes the defensive tackle, it's not roughing the passer. That was interesting.
And my guess is the official may have just seen those two steps after the pass had been released towards the quarterback, may not have seen a push from an Iowa offensive lineman. So now from the 24, it's Kanziri. And a good run as he gets grabbed from behind and thrown down after a gain of 8 yards by Michael Rose Ivey, the linebacker.
The first quarter. Timeout on the field.
Nebraska is going to have some breaks go their way. I don't know that this is rightly called. Malik Collins gets called for roughing the passer right there.
Through one in Lincoln at ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers. We'll continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. 34 more days to New Year's Eve in the college football playoff. ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, part of ESPN's rivalry series, presented by Jiffy Lube. But a lot of love here between the great Tim Dwight on the left, two-time All-American punt returner, and Johnny Rogers, the 1972 Heisman winner. The Big Ten just created the Rogers-Dwight Return Specialist of the Year Award, named after those two fine athletes. Second down two for Iowa to start the second quarter. And it is Jordan Kanziri with those shifty moves for a first down. Works inside the 10. Grabbed by Rose Ivey, but we'll have to check the penalty marker on the play.
Personal foul. Chop block. Offense. Number 38 and 65. 15-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Jordan Walsh, the guard. Adam Cox, the fullback. Teaming up, going high and low.
And simply going high and low. Here's the offensive lineman part of that equation, and then it's the fullback as well. You can see 65 Walsh is engaged, and then Adam Cox, the fullback, gets into the same defender. You can't go high and low on the defender at the same time.
One that's been previously engaged already. So it's second down and 17. That's the second accepted penalty against Iowa. Four already against Nebraska. From the far side of the field. I think they got the spot wrong here. Because the ball's at the 29. I think it should be at the 31. Because the ball was spotted at the 16. So that personal foul penalty, shouldn't it move it back to the 31-yard line?
It sounds like it to me.
This ball's incorrectly spotted. Should be at the 31-yard line. That being said, here's the snap. And Beathard, fullback screen. This is Henry Krieger. Coble picking up all that yardage and more. All the way down to the 10-yard line. First and goal for the Hawkeyes.
And Austin Blythe was actually the center that is out there in front. It's really a one-man screen with Krieger Coble. Going to move the quarterback to the right, and then the tight end is going to sneak back right there, number 80, Krieger Coble, to the left. Blythe is out in front. Very well designed. Nebraska pursues. pursues aggressively, and that's the way to use their aggression against them.
This is where Iowa leans on the run game now in the red zone. Well, they're going to roll out Beathard. He's got an open man, George Kittle. Touchdown, Hawkeyes in Iowa in front. Last week, Iowa had both of its tight ends, Krager Kobel and George Kittle, who are cousins, mind you, score a touchdown. Now a touchdown for Kittle.
And George Kittle is really the red zone finisher. This is his sixth touchdown catch. The tight end on the back side comes all the way across the formation. And Beathard certainly is going to find a guy wide open.
29 rushing TDs in the red zone. But you said it to start the day, Kelly. Iowa got away from tendency. They do it again in the red zone, and Kittle cashes in to put the Hawkeyes in front. There is Amir Abdullah, the outstanding running back for Nebraska, the second-round pick of the Lions, who had a career day yesterday in that 45-14 win over the Eagles on Thanksgiving. 63 yards, a career high for Amir. Good to see him back. This is what's at stake today in this rivalry matchup. Iowa, 11-0, never won 12 games before, trying to stay unbeaten and stay in the college football playoff top four. Meanwhile, Nebraska, with a win, will be bowl eligible only twice since 1962 when Bob Devaney took over. Have they missed the postseason both seasons under Bill Callahan in 04 and 07? Huskers to the 25. Back to John Saunders in the studio.
All right, guys, thanks a lot. We're getting it done. Brought to you by Wells Fargo, Washington and Washington State. Little Apple Cup here. And McCotcher, 26 yards. Good speed once he gets to the open field. 7-3, Washington has the lead. And Oregon against Oregon State. Little civil war here. And Braylon Addison reversing field and just getting it into the end zone for a touchdown to tie the game. Adam McKellar.
How about Washington? They got to get bowl eligible with a win today, and they got to do it against Mike Leach's top 20 team. First down run, it is Imani Cross. Good run, 9 yards. Out to the 34-yard line. Don't forget, a huge weekend of college football this weekend. Part of Rivalry Saturday, our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. You want to watch every game all at once? You got the opportunity. Get your laptop, your phone, your tablet. Download the Watch ESPN app or go to watchespn.com. Of course, Baylor TCU later on tonight. The huge Big 12, Big 10 slate tomorrow. USC UCLA for a chance to go to the Pac-12 championship game tomorrow as well. Second down and one, it's Cross. The lead block from Andy Janovich moves the chains to the 37.
That's the advantage of having Cross in the game. He's 6'1", 230 pounds. And I think when Nebraska's run game got going against Michigan State and Rutgers, that's exactly what they did. They won a couple of tight ends and a bigger back, and they just started moving the pile. It made their run game much more productive and much more efficient.
He's a great short yardage back. 25 career touchdowns in less than 300 carries. But he's been known time to time to open up big bursts of runs. He's had three career 100-yard games as well. Senior out of Gainesville, Georgia. They'll get the play fake. And Armstrong rolling, throwing the deep out, and an attempt at the 40 is incomplete for Alonzo Moore, a redshirt junior. And Nebraska has not been able to move the ball just yet. No, it's not, my friend. That's 40 penalty yards on 4 accepted penalties. That's what ended up helping Iowa out on that last drive. Those 2 personal foul penalties kept that drive alive. 1, which negated a takeaway.
And Nebraska had a penalty, or Iowa had a penalty on their scoring drive, and were able to overcome it. Nebraska hasn't been able to overcome their missteps.
Armstrong keeping it. And spun down at the 41-yard line. Iowa, when we talk about teams that have performed well most of the season, we talk about game control. Nearly 6 hours of game time, 23 quarters. Going back
That's
to the
impressive.
First half of the Illinois game, Iowa has not trailed in a game since that Illinois game.
And the committee, the playoff committee, is aware of that. How do you control the games that you play? And Iowa is in control of most everything they do.
They're ranked top 10 in the country by that metric in game control, which measures a lot of different things against an average team. Armstrong over the middle, and it's broken up. Seathan Carter, that excellent tight end, and Greg Maben gets into that lane and knocks it free.
Well, Seathan Carter is the receiver that Armstrong wants, but he doesn't want him on a matchup with the corner and Maben right here. Craig Maben, that ball was actually behind the receiver to some extent. The ball placement needs to be out in front more, and Greg Maben breaks on the football and knocks it down. But that is the matchup. That is the receiver that Armstrong wants here today.
So Sam Foltz will kick to Desmond King, who again was suspended for the first quarter due to team violation. And King muffs the football. It's loose, and the Huskers have it. Nick Stoltenberg. You cannot advance a muff of a punt, so it will be taken over near the 31-yard line by Nebraska. But the Huskers will take over. The redshirt freshman out of Gretna, Mick Stoltenberg, Johnny on the spot to scoop it.
Ruling on the field was the kick was muffed by the receiving team, recovered by the kicking team. First down, Nebraska.
You cannot advance a muffed punt. That's why it's spotted, but it is Husker football.
And the first time we hear from Desmond King, it's certainly not in a good way. He's a very good returner, takes his eye off the ball to some extent. But remember this, Adam, that punt was going into a stiff breeze. That ball begins to knuckleball a little bit, and I think King had trouble with that.
That will be an issue all day long as Stoltenberg comes up clutch. And now Nebraska gets excellent field position at the 31-yard line. Really nowhere to go for a batted cross there. Meyer among a slew of Hawkeyes to grab him and stop him for a loss of two.
Remember this, Adam. Obviously, it's not about takeaways. It's about points off of takeaways. And Nebraska's offense isn't exactly lighting it up, but they need to take advantage of this short field right here.
We talk about turnover margin. Already an issue in this ball game today, an interception thrown by Tommy Armstrong. But Stoltenberg scoops up the miss by King.
It's not a difficult game. Take care of the rock and you typically do good things.
Fake the reverse to Moore. Check it down for Carter. First down. And Seathan Carter pushing the pile inside the 10-yard line. First and goal, Nebraska.
All of the fly motion minutia before the ball was thrown, and then Seathan Carter leaks out at the right time. There's been a notable increase in targeting Seathan Carter, and you can see it right there.
Ferentz is very upset. A late flag was thrown as well after the play.
Iowa is assessed the sideline warning.
And after Ron Snodgrass declared the sideline warning, the side judge just threw his flag as well.
Is that the second sideline warning or is that a 15?
Unsportsmanlike conduct is assessed against the Iowa sideline. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
That'll be a half the distance, so to spot the football at the 4-yard line for Nebraska. And Kirk Ferentz showing a lot of emotion early in this game, getting after the officials a little bit. It's a give to Cross. And Amani Cross has a Nebraska touchdown. Takes advantage of that muffed punt Desmond King. And Drew Brown ties the game at 7. Imani Cross, great short yardage back. 26 career rushing touchdowns, and the Huskers have knotted it up. Feed a very hungry Nebraska Cornhusker football team on this Thanksgiving.
How you were eating last night when I saw you.
Absolutely. ESPN College Football on ABC presented by K Jewelers continues. Second quarter tied at 7. The Dr. Pepper championship drive game of the week. This is what Kirk Ferentz did to earn himself the sideline penalty. Now, again, the first call against him was a sideline warning. The flag,
right?
Is
yes.
Thrown, but it doesn't cost you anything. It's merely a warning. But after that play, just showing his frustration and perhaps saying something he didn't want to say or shouldn't have said, that led to that penalty being called. It added 4 more yards on a half the distance. And that's what helped Nebraska score a touchdown. Short punt. They're going to keep this away from Desmond King. And it is Riley McCarron from the 18-yard line getting this return. And he'll work his way out to the 35. Big 12 on full display tonight and tomorrow. Baylor and TCU on ESPN at 7:30 Eastern time tonight. Then tomorrow, the Bedlam Series with so much at stake in both games. Oklahoma and Oklahoma State from Stillwater. It's part of our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. Oklahoma can end it all with a win tomorrow in Stillwater. Oklahoma State can clinch with a win and a Baylor loss against either TCU tonight or Texas next week. Baylor's got a win against TCU and Texas, and they're going to be big Oklahoma State fans. Remember, Baylor delivered Oklahoma State's first loss a week ago. So they have the tiebreaker over the Cowboys. From the 36-yard line, running the reverse. This is Vandenberg. Field and he gets chopped down at the 45. Brought down by Michael Rose Ivy. Good run of 9.
Nebraska has defended Iowa's run really well, and so you have to throw in some of this stuff, some misdirection in the end. Vandenberg ends up with the ball back again on the reverse, but with Valentine and Malik Collins inside, Iowa's might have a tough time running the football today, so you have to mix it up in the run game just like that.
Here's Daniels, ran into his own offensive lineman in Sean Welsh, but still surged forward to the 46, and it will be enough for the first down.
Adam, that's exactly why I thought Nebraska was a good matchup against Iowa, because what they can do defensively inside, I think Vincent Valentine and Malik Collins are probably the best duo of defensive tackles in this conference, and that's where it starts with Iowa. You have to take away the run inside the box and force them to try to get to the edges in that run game.
Beathard deep drop. Looking for a deep route to develop. The pocket collapses, and Beathard taken off and physically running out of bounds. We'll see where they spot him as Nate Gary was closing in. Looks like the 45, so just shy of the line to gain.
Well, Olivia talked about this before the game. C.J. Beathard is about as healthy as he's been in a long while, and this adds a lot to their offense. It's because of plays like this. So many of his scrambles are converted for first downs, and there's a good example of it. He comes up maybe just a little bit short, but you have to check him in pass situations and certainly on third down situations.
To Daniels, and he lost the football. Looked like he dove back on top of it as Kevin Maurice with the penetration, drilling Daniels back to midfield.
Maurice is one of those guys that's getting healthy again after being injured, and increasing that rotation and depth at the defensive tackle position just blows up the zone blocking scheme, and Iowa was fortunate to jump back on that one.
Six-man rush from the Huskers. Beathard with time and one-on-one and a low pass. pass is incomplete. Looking for Smith. Good coverage by Jonathan Rose on that outside. The former Auburn Tiger with the help on the defense to set up fourth down.
Devon Smith was out there by himself in the 3-by-1 set. Jonathan Rose did a great job of using the sideline as essentially his protector, and he defended that, what was supposed to be a back shoulder throw, very well.
So there is Westerkamp, who's returned 5 punts in his season. And will be Marshall Kane again. He had a 17-yard shank on a rugby-style punt earlier. He's going to keep it low and look for a good bounce. And he will get one. Pinned inside the 10-yard line on a 40-yard punt by the redshirt senior. As good of an insult as it comes between Iowa and Nebraska, insult the corn. That being said, rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube going back to 1891 as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary so far. This is an Iowa offense that has scored 4 or more points in 5 consecutive games, tying a program record. They've been stymied a little bit, but both teams with 7 points on the board thus far. Long field in front of Tommy Armstrong Jr. and the Huskers. Zone read. Here comes Nugent. Grabbed by Maben in the open field. A good tackle after a 3-yard gain.
And you can see right there what Iowa does defensively is they're not really an across the field, upfield type of team. They fit gaps really well, and then they support well. Greg Maben right there supports from his corner position, and Newby needs to understand that. Plant your foot and get downhill and get what you can get, and you're not going to get it outside on a play like that against Iowa defensively very often.
Iowa's defense been a little leaky the last 3 games or so. They bring pressure, safety pressure. It's tipped into the air and picked off, and Parker Hesse bangs it in for a touchdown. Iowa brought safety pressure that time, forcing Armstrong into a much quicker throw than he wanted.
Yeah, the safety was Miles Taylor, number 19, comes right up the middle, and very good timing on the pressure, and Parker Hesse tips the ball to himself. What a huge play, but the second interception by Armstrong this time leads directly to a score.
Parker Hesse, the redshirt freshman with his first career pick, taking over that defensive end spot left by the outstanding and injured Drew Ott, who tore his ACL against Illinois. He has applied for a 5th year of eligibility in the last few days. Hesse has stepped into that role left by a very good player and comes up clutch with a big defensive play to put Iowa in front. Second interception of the day from Tommy Armstrong on a hurried throw. And Parker Hesse with an excellent play for the 4th Iowa pick 6 of the season. And it has given the Hawkeyes a 14-7 lead. An Iowa defense that has been a little bit more leaky the last 3 games or so. Phil Parker, the defensive coordinator, was not pleased fully with the performance the last couple of weeks. Nebraska again out to the 25-yard line. As we take a look at our good hands play, it's brought to you by Allstate. No surprise, it belongs to Parker Hesse, the redshirt freshman.
You talk about being in the right place at the right time. You can see right there, Philly Parker Hesse tips it up in the air, takes it away. And this actually isn't a bad play on inside pressure. You can see number 19, Miles Taylor, comes up inside, and Hesse gets up the field, which he should do. But you have a swing screen to your running back. The quarterback Armstrong just needs to get the ball over top of the long arm of Hesse.
On first down, it's Newby running into Bauer. Remember, Bauer is into the game after Ben Neiman had to leave the game after a big hit took Neiman out.
And Adam, we know that Iowa is so good defensively against the run. I know that play caller for Nebraska, Danny Langsdorf, would like to throw on first down a little bit, but right now, Can you trust your quarterback to do that? That's the question.
Quick throw, Brandon Riley. And he gets driven out of bounds at the 37-yard line. Good enough for a first down in front of Desmond King.
Desmond King made that really, really easy. Riley just runs a hitch route. Very well thrown, good timing, good ball placement leads to chain mover. Nebraska needs a lot of that right here.
And King, remember, leads the country with 8 interceptions. That's tied for an Iowa record with Lou King and Niall Kinnick himself. Finalist for the Jim Thorpe Award, along with Jeremy Cash of Duke and Vernon Hargraves, outstanding corner at Florida. Deep drop for Armstrong. Looking downfield for Riley. He's covered by King. So Armstrong will take off and run out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Speaking of the Florida Gators, they're part of an ESPN doubleheader tomorrow, including number one Clemson in the 107th straight meeting between Clemson and South Carolina, and then a big one between Florida and Florida State, both top 15 teams. Part of our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube at noon Eastern and 7:30 Eastern time. Dabo Swinney has not won in Columbia, South Carolina, surprisingly. Here is Newby cutting it back, and he's got a first down into Iowa territory. Jordan Lomax stopped him in the open field after a dozen.
And this is what Newby brings to the run game. Not only the eyes to see the cutback line, this is designed to go left. It's also the quickness to get there. You can see it all you want, but you have to have the quick feet to get over there. And Newby has that, is able to take advantage of a nice run right there.
Los Angeles native who shunned some Pac-12 offers to come to Nebraska and be a feature running back now in his junior season. Cross is back in. Fake the cross, swinging out for Jamal Turner. And Turner with good yardage on first down. But grabbed by Jewell after he picks up about 8.5.
Thus far on this drive, Nebraska responding really well and mixing it up a little bit. And I think the quick passing game out of Armstrong to get him settled in a little bit. And it adds really a perimeter run game, essentially. Those quick passes outside that screen game adds to the ability Nebraska has already shown they have to run in inside the box.
Put his knee down at the 42, and it's 2nd and 3. Play action. Jewell is right there in front of Armstrong, who clears the pocket to buy time and throws incomplete. Looking for Lane Hovey, the Iowa native, a big Iowa Hawkeye fan growing up. Hovey on the perimeter has been more of a factor in the offense the last couple of games. 3rd down and 3 for Nebraska.
In the last couple of plays, Iowa has defended really well out of that Nebraska play-action passing game, and Armstrong has desired to go deep, but Iowa has covered things down the field very well.
25 of those 44 yards came on that completion to Seathan Carter that helped set up the Nebraska touchdown. On 3rd and 3. Nothing there for Armstrong, who gets chased down by Nate Meyer, and Armstrong forced to fling it away. Excellent coverage downfield by the Iowa defense.
And Iowa typically starts out of quarters coverage, and then a lot of times it turns into man without any help. Go ahead and let it roll right here. There's actually a rotation of the safeties, and everybody is locked down. In the end, you get Westerkamp doubled inside and out. That's why Iowa is so good defensively. They read their keys. It's about alignment and assignment with that group from Iowa.
Again, with the wind as big of a factor as it is today, going into the wind right now and in no man's land at the 42-yard line, they're going to try to convert on 4th and 3. They're 4 of 5 on 4th down this year. Batted away. It is caught by Terrell Newby, and he's hit shy of the line to gain by Josie Jewell. Jewell was the one who deflected it. Jewell was the one who closed the play down, and Iowa takes over on downs.
And Iowa didn't get a great push right there, but they did get their hands up and get in the run, the throwing lane of Tommy Armstrong right here. The slight play action pass, and then you get a defender, Jewel, that gets up and knocks that ball away. Nowhere to throw the football. Quite frankly, it was covered downfield once again.
So decent field position at the 43-yard line for the Hawkeyes. Here's Kanziri with a block from Cox and a gain of about 3.5 or 4. Josh Bandera is on the stop. There does seem to be a little bit of concern as to why Kirk Ferentz picked up that sideline warning penalty. I believe we were told that Seathan Carter on that 25-yard reception should have been called for illegal formation because he was covered up at the end of the line. Seemingly that is what upset Kirk Ferentz earlier in this quarter. Here is Beathard rolling and throwing and couldn't get much behind that rollout pass for Vandenberg. Brings up 3rd down and 6. And that penalty gave some additional yardage to Nebraska, helped them set up that touchdown along with that Seathan Carter reception. Third down and 6, Cal. 0-for-4 are the Hawkeyes converting third down. They're one of the best teams in the country on third down this year. They haven't been able to move the chains yet. Beathard, nothing. Backpedaling, throwing for Smith. He nearly caught it, and then the play was blown up by Nate Gary. But this is going to be a penalty flag as Gary came in very dangerously with forcible contact. A frightening collision between Gary and Smith. We'll get the call from Ron Snodgrass, but that was a very scary sight with Smith stretching out to try to grab that ball with two hands, nearly corralled it, and Gary came flying in. This is a potential personal foul and targeting penalty with forcible contact above the shoulders. Clearly, you can read the lips of Ron Snodgrass. It is targeting, which is a reviewable play. But it is a personal foul, so it will be a penalty either way. And forcible contact above the shoulders. I understand Nate Gary's trying to make a play, which he did, but this is likely going to be a targeting penalty that stands against Nate Gary, which would mean an ejection from this game.
And I think rightly called on the field. And remember, targeting can be with the crown of the helmet, or it can be a defenseless player, in this case a defenseless receiver, above the shoulders and the head and neck. And that's exactly what it looks like. Nate Gary.
It fits both of these axioms.
Exactly.
The targeting of a defenseless opponent above, or with forcible contact above the shoulders, or leading with the crown of the helmet. Ron Snodgrass indicating to the crowd that it will be a targeting penalty. It will stand, so Nate Gary, unfortunately for Nebraska, will be ejected from this game.
And he obviously doesn't know it right now, but remember what Nebraska loses on the back end of Nate Gary is his valuable experience from that safety position. Beathard's throw drifts upfield just a little bit right there, and it puts his receiver, Tavon Smith, in harm's way, and then Gary, he does lead with the crown of the helmet, but he also strikes the defenseless receiver above the shoulders. Correctly called.
That's a big loss. He's their leading pass interceptor. He's their leading tackler. He's one of their best pass defense guys. One of the veterans playing in his 38th career game, trying to get the crowd up on its feet as he leaves. So now Aaron Williams, the true freshman from Atlanta, takes over. Good to see Tavon Smith moving around on his own on the sideline for Iowa. Beathard from the 38-yard line. Throws the comeback route, and it was nearly intercepted by Josh Kalu. Pass a little wayward from Beathard, and it brings up second down.
This certainly could have been picked by Kalu, but it gets on him so fast. And once again, an errant throw. That ball drifted upfield as well. A quarterback, a lot of times, the wind is at the back of C.J. Beathard currently. And that ball looks like it's being pushed further downfield than Beathard is anticipating.
Kanziri hit in the backfield by Malik Collins immediately. A tackle for loss back at the 40, and it sets up third down and long.
Malik Collins is so quick from his defensive tackle position. You can see he actually fights around the block by Jordan Walsh and then goes back inside and blows up the play. Quick feet by a big man. He's 300 pounds.
And third down and long, 0 for 4 on third down so far in this game as Iowa. And this play is whistled dead. Penalty marker from the sideline on the near side. I believe they called Cole Croston the right tackle for a false start. Ron Snodgrass's audio is now working on his microphone. So it's a 5-yard penalty, and Iowa even further behind the chains. Hawkeyes offense playing as well as it has all season long during this last 5-game stretch. Nebraska looking for a stop right now. Just a 3-man rush. Forces Beathard out of the pocket. And throws to the sticks. And it is incomplete. Looking for Smith. It's going to be ruled out of bounds when he made the catch with Smith, which Smith cannot believe as he was coming back to the ball. But it was ruled incomplete, and it brings up fourth down.
Nebraska went with the zone that time. 3-deep zone, and you can see the zone underneath, and I think it was a very good defensive call. I think his Smith's feet were simply out of bounds. He did catch the football in the tight coverage by Jonathan Rose, but his feet were already out of bounds.
I also wonder if perhaps he stepped out of bounds and then came back into the field to play, but I did not see a referee with his hat off. Let's see here. Yeah, that is a good call. You had that right foot sliding on that white when the ball got to Tavon Smith.
Yeah, it wasn't a matter of possessing the ball, but you have to obviously possess it in bounds, and Smith doesn't do it right there. But I like the zone coverage on the back end. Third and long is typically a zone down defensively anyway, but it also allows you to keep C.J. Beathard in the pocket.
Penalty marker is thrown. I believe the play clock was winding down. Play clock was at 0 a moment ago, and a penalty marker thrown for a delay of game. So Westerkamp back to return, and Kidd is able to get her away under pressure. Fair catch at the 20. Coming up on our Capital One halftime report, Olivia Harlan will have an interview with Kirk Ferentz. John Saunders and Mark May will get you caught up on everything going on today and get you set for Rivalry Saturday, a preview of what is to be a very crucial final weekend of November with the Big Ten, Big 12, Pac-12 South championships all up for grabs. Earlier today, Houston won the American Conference West Division with their win over Navy. Two timeouts, a minute 11, two interceptions on his resume today, but Tommy Armstrong with a chance to march Nebraska down the field. Swing it out for Newby with a little bit of open space. And Newby picks up good yardage to the 28. Running into Miles Taylor, clock inside of a minute. Still looking downfield, throwing it deep, and it's caught by Carter. Out of bounds at the 44-yard line in Iowa territory. Second big play for Seathan Carter today.
Armstrong is great outside the initial design of the play. This is when he's at his best, if it ends in an accurate throw and a good decision. And right here, he makes both of them really well.
It's off the edge. Armstrong off his back foot. Once again, it's Ethan Carter at the 25-yard line.
Well, the pressure was by Parker Hesse right there, and that's why Armstrong had to throw off his back foot, but he can do that from time to time. You don't recommend it. It's bad mechanics, but he made a really good throw to Carter right there.
We've seen a little bit of awkward mechanics at times. This one worked out for Armstrong.
Yeah, and he throws a strike down the field. You can see he doesn't step into the throw, but that time it was necessarily so. And number 11, Seathan Carter, eventually gets to the middle of the field, finds the void, and catches a knuckleball into the wind right there.
Armstrong had that brutal start, 2 of 7 with a couple of picks. He is 6 for his last 8, and a lot of that has gone to Seathan Carter.
Yeah, and we thought that Seathan Carter could be a matchup issue for Iowa when you could get him on a linebacker, a nickelback, or the safeties. He's typically going to win that with that big body, but Armstrong has looked a lot better here of late. You're absolutely right.
They used a timeout to stop the clock at 25 seconds. It would be about a 42-yard field goal try from here into the wind.
Yeah, exactly. Into a really, really stiff wind going that direction.
So Armstrong trying to move the ball further. It just went 47 yards on 2 plays to Carter. Armstrong keeping the play alive. Throwing for the end zone. And that ball is incomplete. Looking for Westerkamp. 16 seconds left, and that ball almost looked like it got caught up in the wind a little bit and knuckled on its way towards the end zone and floated out.
Yeah, in the end, it was Westerkamp matched up on Desmond King, and it became a 50-50 ball in the end zone. I don't really mind the play, to be quite honest with you, because it was either Westerkamp going up and making a play or the ball goes harmlessly out of bounds.
You saw Drew Brown warming up. He's been outstanding from beyond 40 yards as of late, but again, that wind is a major factor today. On second down, over the middle, Armstrong finds Jamal Turner. And Maben brings him down with 8 seconds left at the 22-yard line, and now you have to call a timeout if you're Nebraska to potentially set up a field goal. So the Huskers use their final timeout here.
Nebraska was setting up the tunnel screen back inside to Jamal Turner, and very well defended by Iowa. They read their keys so well, Adam, on that defensive side for Iowa. They are rarely out of place.
So Drew Brown is 8 for his last 8. All of those kicks, all 8 of the last kicks that Brown has attempted have been 40 yards or more. This one will be right around 40, maybe a little bit inside of it. Remember, he hit a 20-yard field goal to force overtime against Iowa a season ago in Iowa City, and that's what he's dealing with, kicking into what is an incredibly stiff wind, kicking to the north side of Memorial Stadium. This will be just inside of 40 yards. Drew Brown dealing with the wind, and man, was that pretty. 33rd career field goal make for Drew Brown.
And he pounds this one. This could have been good from way back. Hits his stinger into the wind, and it was right in the middle, and Coach Riley knows they needed those 3 points going into the half.
Remember, Drew's brother Chris was an outstanding kicker at Nebraska, turned out a 12-year NFL career, and Drew's doing some really good things, the Texas native. Hits that field goal, and we remind you that we're celebrating our 11th year with Allstate sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. And to date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds. Brown, a solid kicker in his own right. Pretty good kickoff guy as well. We'll see what they do here, though, if they're going to go squib. Last time, they actually kept it short to get away from Desmond King. Picked up by Kittle. Then he'll just go ahead and take the knee. That'll take us to halftime. Playoff hopes at stake for the Hawkeyes, a bowl berth at stake for the Huskers. Olivia will have Kirk Ferentz coming up during our Capital One halftime report, which comes her way after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Welcome back to ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers. It's part of ESPN's rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. Unbeaten, fourth ranked in the college football playoff rankings, the Iowa Hawkeyes, who have not trailed in a game since the Illinois game 24 quarters ago, have the 14-10 lead at the halftime break on Nebraska. Adam Amin, Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan on the field as well. So much at stake in this game for Iowa, trying to go unbeaten with an eye towards the college football playoff. Nebraska trying to get to a bowl game, and we saw the physicality in the cold weather. This feels like an Iowa-Nebraska game in late November.
Not exactly an offensive showdown, right?
Sure, understandably so.
I think in the weather, but also I think this is a really good matchup for Nebraska, quite frankly, because they're very stout in the middle against Iowa's run. And I think it all comes back to what I said in the beginning. Tommy Armstrong taking care of the football and his decision-making is going to determine whether Nebraska can find a way to win this in the second half or whether Iowa does indeed end up 12-0.
Nebraska deferred to the second half, so they'll have the ball first. In the third quarter, playoff positioning at stake for the Hawkeyes, who have never won 12 games in a season. The Huskers can guarantee themselves a bowl bid with an upset today. And the Huskers will start at the 25-yard line. As we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary from that opening half of play, big play was the second Tommy Armstrong interception when Parker Hesse got into the backfield, tipped the ball up, and got this touchdown to make it 14-7. Tommy Armstrong kind of epitomized in that first half, really.
Yeah, exactly. He didn't get off to a good start through two egregious interceptions and bad mechanics, bad footwork, but then we see this. Good Tommy getting outside the pocket and making a plays with his feet and making really good decisions.
On first down, it's Amani Cross running into Johnson after a gain of 5 yards. A Nebraska offense that has gotten better in its last two games against Michigan State, against Rutgers, putting up 30-plus points in those games. The offensive line is seemingly in those games played a little bit better. How do you assess those things so far?
I think the offensive line has played pretty well in the first half. I think it really all funnels right down to whether Tommy Armstrong makes good decisions. I think these teams are very evenly matched here this afternoon.
And a 5-6 record does not indicate the type of season that Nebraska's had. Just Cross once again, and not much there as Nathan Budgeta, a redshirt sophomore and Nebraska native out of Dodge High School, makes the stop to set up 3rd and 5.
You know, Adam, these teams are actually quite similar. The difference is C.J. Beathard rarely makes mistakes. He's only thrown 3 picks on the year, and Armstrong tends to go off the radar a little bit and throw the ball to the other guys too often.
Now 14 interceptions, a career high for Armstrong this year. Just a 4-man rush on 3rd down. It is caught by Carter, but he is shy of the line to gain, and not by much. That forward progress marked at about the 39 and a half, very close to the sticks.
Jaleel Johnson was getting after Armstrong, and then Cole Fisher breaks on the tight end and gets him to the ground and forces a punt, and that is quintessential Iowa defense, quite frankly. Find a way to get off the field, make a sure tackle, and force a punt.
Desmond King with a muffed punt in that first half helped lead to a Nebraska drive that ended in points. King will field it out of bounds. And King trying to cut it back and gets a block from Lomax. And he works into Nebraska territory, driven out by Stoltenberg with a penalty marker thrown from the far side of the field.
I think Sam Foltz came in late, and I think he's going to get another 15 added on to the end of that run.
Redshirt junior punter getting in a little late after a 26-yard return.
Personal foul. Late hit. The kicking team. Number 27, 15-yard penalty, first down.
So basically, they lose a yard on the punt with the 26-yard return and a 15-yard flag on Foltz.
And Foltz is hustling, but obviously this is late. It's 3 yards out of bounds, and it was completely unnecessary. Desmond King was obviously out of bounds, and those are the things that get you beat in close games.
6 accepted penalties, 4 personal fouls against Nebraska. And from the 33-yard line, Kanziri. And Jordan Kanziri with a solid run. Works his way for about 3 yards as we check in with Olivia Harlow.
Guys, big thing in the first half, as you mentioned, was Iowa not being able to convert on third down. I asked Coach Riley how they were able to do it, and he really liked the pressure. As for Tommy Armstrong's 2 picks in the first half, he was at least happy he had a good 2-minute drive, but kind of sighed and said he hopes he can respond well. And guys, the wind has been such a big factor, not as much in kicks and punts, but in pass game, he said. He's hoping that is settled down in the second half, but the wind's still howling, guys.
Yeah, Beathard is going with the wind right now as Kanziri gets a block from Pleba and has open space. Touchdown, Iowa. Jordan Kanziri into the end zone. Back-to-back weeks with a touchdown in his third game back from the ankle injury, and now Iowa has taken a 2-score lead.
Iowa offensively is not a high-volume offense, but what they do really well. You can see the lead outside by the fullback, and then Kanziri dashes it up inside. Limited runs, but they do them extremely well.
Kidd was able to corral a low snap, and Kane is able to put it through. Didn't take long. C.J. Beathard just handed it off for the senior out of Troy, New York. They talked about his durability and size coming out of high school. Jordan Kanziri playing at a Big Ten school, proving a lot of people wrong. Back in Lincoln, Nebraska, ESPN College Football and ABC presented by K Jewelers, part of our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube and the Iowa Hawkeyes. With an 11-point lead, Jordan Kanziri, his only major offers out of high school were UConn and Villanova. And he said he wanted to go to the Big Ten after everybody told him that he was too small to play in a power-running conference, and he has been a dynamite back. Iowa's best overall this season. Another good kick by Marshall Kane, one of the best touchback kickers in the nation. And out to the 25 comes Nebraska. Stillwater for the 5th time is where College Game Day, built by the Home Depot, will be. But some terrible news out of the Big Ten. Lloyd Carr's grandson, Chad, last 14 months of his all-too-brief life strengthened a Michigan man's family. We will talk about that story tomorrow. Of course, it is Rivalry Saturday. We'll revisit several of the rivalry games that you'll see over the course of the day, including Bedlam in Stillwater. And maybe the funniest thing that you could find, we got a great, funny feature on the Surrender Cobra, which you see on the faces of a lot of disappointed fans during some big-time college football games. All part of Game Day in Stillwater for the 5th time. Running in the round here. A very short pickup. Jordan Lomax ran down Brandon Riley very quickly at the 27 on a gain of 2.
Nebraska coming out in this second half, just trying to get the run game going to some extent. They were decent between the tackles, but the explosives tend to come on the edges, and Nebraska hasn't been able to get out there very often.
Containment is something Phil Parker, absolutely, the defensive coordinator, talked about, especially with Armstrong, because he felt that last year's meeting, Armstrong got out of the pocket too much for big plays. Armstrong is looking for Riley, and he gets defended well by Bo Bauer. And throws a dangerous pass into traffic, and it's incomplete. Well, you saw a little bit of good and bad Tommy Armstrong right there. Able to extend the play, but making a potentially crucial and bad decision.
Yeah, that was a bad decision. It just ended fortunately enough for him. He's inside the pocket, so you can't just airmail this across the line of scrimmage, and then he throws it into harm's way. And quite frankly, that's the difference between Nebraska offensively and maybe winning 3 or 4 more games than they have this year. It's decisions like that that have driven Mike Riley absolutely bad.
Iowa's showing pressure on 3rd and long, and they will only rush 3. Going zone here. And Armstrong looking for space to try to run, and he gets past the 35-yard line for a 1st down.
That's exactly where Tommy Armstrong needs to use this ability. Extending a play, extending a drive, and you can literally hear the fans here essentially telling him where to go. They started cheering when they saw his ability to extend this drive, and Tommy Armstrong makes a good decision right there.
Over 1,200 rushing yards in his career. Thrice today he has rushed for a 1st down. Here is Newby. Grabbed by Fisher. And about a yard on the play. Nebraska is second in the Big Ten in offense, total offense behind the Indiana Hoosiers, but there have been some games where you feel like they could have added more points had it not been for some of the turnovers that we've seen from the Huskers over the course of this season. That's why that 5-6 record is not really indicative of the type of team that they are. I think the last 2 weeks, Mike Riley said the atmosphere has been different and the team looks like what we thought it could look like early in the year after those wins against Michigan State and Rutgers. Armstrong throwing on the run for Westerkamp. And his roommate is there to make the catch for a first down at the Iowa 48-yard line.
A boot concept and then a smash route outside. And Westerkamp has the corner part of that smash route. And, wow, that was an interesting catch. I'd be surprised if play doesn't stop here for the replay booth to take a further look at this.
Tom Fiedler is our replay official. Haven't had to check up with him pretty much at all in this game. The snap will go off, and Armstrong on a designed run. Great containment by the Iowa defense, and how about the game that Greg Maben is having, tackling on the edge. Forces Armstrong back, but there is a penalty marker on the play as well. Talked about containment. Phil Parker stressed that against this Nebraska offense.
When Greg Maben is the contained guy out there on the edge, you're exactly right. And in particular, keeping Armstrong inside, and that's what Maben did right there.
Five tackles and a pass breakup today for Maben. Be a penalty against Nebraska here.
Personal foul. Chop block. Offense. Number 34 and 68. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Terrell Newby and the right tackle, the redshirt freshman out of Vegas, Nick Gates.
Remember, a chop block is simply that two, you can see right there, there's a Nick Gates is up high and then Newby goes down low. It was actually Dylan Utter that was the guy that was blocking high. Well called on the field.
Yeah, they gave 68 instead of 66. First down in a quarter of the field. Flinging it out to Sam Cotton, and he gets some of that penalty yardage back. Working back near midfield as Bo Bauer ran him down. Just the ninth career catch for the redshirt junior out of Lincoln Southeast High School. There is Phil Parker, 17th season on staff. Defensive back coach until 2011. Took over for Norm Parker, the late Norm Parker. No relation between the two. He had retired after the 2011 season, and Parker's been the defensive coordinator ever since. The defense has been a little leaky the last few games, playing well so far today. Off play action from a much more manageable second down and 11. Westerkamp inside the 25-yard line. If there's a safety valve on the outside for Nebraska, it's Tommy Armstrong's roommate, Jordan Westerkamp, who has his 63rd catch of the season.
And a similar route concept as Westerkamp just caught a minute ago. Eventually, he's going to go to the corner as number 82, Alonzo Moore, clears out with the vertical route, and then Westerkamp slips into that void outside. Great design and a great route, and then his roommate Armstrong finds it.
They love running that route concept to bring Westerkamp to the outside. This is Newby. Diving ahead into Fisher. Works to the 20. Westerkamp's a weapon on the outside. They've got Brandon Riley, who's played really well as of late. Morgan's had a good season. They're trying to find these receivers now. This is Jamal Turner close to a first down. And the redshirt senior is close to the sticks.
And the first time we've seen Nebraska use up-tempo right there after the big catch by Westerkamp. They go up-tempo and get another nice play on just a now screen out to Jamal Turner.
They went from first and 25 to being able to convert, and now they have third and two in the red zone. Armstrong design run and another rushing first down for Tommy Armstrong. Pushing the pile with Lomax grabbing him, and he sets up first and goal at the five.
So many good things have happened on this drive for Nebraska. Using Armstrong in the run game right there, that was a no-brainer at third and two. But remember, remember, like you said, Adam, it was first and 25. That's a lot of negative yardage to overcome. Well blocked at the point of attack. You get Cross up in there as a 230-pound lead blocker in that case, and Armstrong takes advantage of it.
Cross seeking space, and Cross surges in. Touchdown, Huskers. Offensive drive of the game for the Huskers, marching 75 yards down the field.
And it was a pass game first to open up the run game. It's really reverse of what Nebraska and Iowa, quite frankly, typically want to do. Very good block by the fullback, Andy Janovich, in the two running back run game, and then Cross finishes tough up inside.
And Brown makes it a four-point game. Nebraska came back from 17 down a year ago. Iowa fans are well aware what this Nebraska team can do in this type of ball game. Cross with his second score, and it's a four-point lead for the Hawkeyes. ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, and a four-point Iowa Hawkeye lead as part of our Dr. Pepper Championship Drive Game of the Week. You saw some of the shots from a 124 and one-day-old rivalry. One day ago and 124 years ago, this rivalry started at the Omaha Athletic Club in front of 2,500 fans.
2,500?
In 1891. How about that?
What do we have in here, about 99,000 or something today?
Definitely 90,000 plus. Iowa nearly had to back out the night before. Nebraska had never played a team from outside the state of Iowa. Iowa nearly didn't have the money to take the train tickets to get to Omaha to play this 1891 football team. But halfback Will Larrabee's dad was a former governor. He helped secure a $200 loan to help the Iowa Hawkeyes travel to play against Nebraska in 1891. Dirk Chatlin in the Omaha World Herald wrote an outstanding article documenting that 1891 game, the first of the series. Riley McCarron from the 12-yard line. And he lost the football. The Hawkeyes may have it. Riley McCarron nearly coughed it up and did, and it was Desmond King who was able to jump back on top of it at the 32-yard line, a break for Iowa.
Riley McCarron returning this kick, and very fortunate that Iowa got back on this. A great hit right on the point of the football. Right there. It's exactly how you do it, and I think it was Jonathan Rose that put his helmet right on the ball.
And McCarron, who has had to return a couple of kicks when they've gone short from Nebraska. Nearly disastrous play. From the 32, it's where Iowa starts with the lead. Here is Kanziri with a big hole. There goes Jordan Kanziri. And a New York native is going to burst one open for an Iowa rushing touchdown. Yards for Kanziri. Iowa responds in a big way.
Exactly the same play, same design as Kanziri just scored on the touchdown before. Lead with Adam Cox, the fullback, out on the edge. And Nebraska's linebackers took bad pursuit angles, and the secondary was nowhere to be found. Exact same play, Adam, that Jordan Kanziri scored on before.
Second longest touchdown run of his career at a 75-yarder against Illinois. And it's back-to-back Iowa drives that have ended with the ball in Kanziri's belly and then have ended with an Iowa touchdown in the end zone. Kanziri does it again. They respond, and it's back to a double-digit lead. Major playoff and Big 12 implications when Baylor and TCU square off on ESPN tonight. Then John Butchergross, Steve Levy will get things going after the game for SportsCenter at night. Jay Harris, Kenny Mayne will take you on the West Coast after that. You can end your day on a highlight with SportsCenter at night on ESPN, streaming live on Watch ESPN as well. That Baylor-TCU game, buckle your belts for that one tonight because a lot riding on it, especially for the Bears who need two wins and an Oklahoma State win tomorrow to win the Big 12. Here's the freshman Stanley Morgan for Nebraska, and he's brought down shy of the 20. We'll mark them down right there as we take a look at today's AT&T Strong Performance. Let's talk Jordan Kanziri.
Kanziri, if it works one time, how about let's do it again? And Kanziri right here is led by the fullback. Makem Pleva is the leader on that particular play. And then Adam Cox leads on that one. Same design, same play, exactly the same result. Kind of a stretch outside, lead by the fullback. And Nebraska obviously had no answer.
Sixth time he's run for over 100. Remember, he had the huge game earlier this year with 256 against Illinois. He's been Iowa's best running back all year. Newby on first down takes it for five as we check in with John Saunders in the studio.
All right, guys. Well, Oregon State going about the way you might expect. Already 24-7 when Vernon Adams to Braylon Addison says to trot into the end zone for a touchdown. Meantime, TCU and Baylor. Remember a year ago? They played in week 7. They'll be playing in the slough this time around.
Man, John, the weather does not look good there. Looking for Riley. Leaping into the air. Did he hold on to it? He did! What a catch! Brandon Riley had that ball pop into the air and then snatched it on the way down from his backside of the 48-yard line.
Brandon Riley matched up on Desmond King, and typically Desmond King the one coming down with this ball. This is what a 50-50 ball looks like right there.
Swinging it out right side. This is Moore. A couple of receivers out of the perimeter to help him out. Pick up some yardage to the 44.
Nebraska offensively, Adam, is going to have those chunk plays like we just saw to Brandon Riley on that 50-50 ball. He comes down with it, and Desmond King does it.
Riley looks shaken up, kind of grabbing towards his left side, maybe towards his left leg, but he looked a little bit banged up on that play. It went tempo, so he didn't have a chance to get off the field after he made that great catch. From shot position, Armstrong on play action, looking for more in double coverage. Picked up by Greg Maven. Maven to the 29-yard line out of bounds. Second interception of the season for the redshirt junior out of Fort Lauderdale.
Remember that Armstrong is trying to throw this into the wind. It's Alonzo Moore is on the post down the middle of the field, and initially it looks like a middle of the field open type of read, but remember what Iowa does defensively. Their quarters coverage in that far safety doesn't have anything to do, so Greg Maven just reads the quarterback, reads the route, and then goes and makes a play on the football. That's what makes Iowa so tough defensively, Adam, is they know their alignment, they know their assignment, they know their keys, and then they finish on the football so, so well.
Third pick for Tommy Armstrong Jr. today in Iowa. On a couple of fakes, has Beathard looking downfield. George Kittle is there to make the grab at the 45-yard line for the Hawkeyes. He's got a touchdown on the game today. He picks up 25 yards there.
And this is a quick transition offense. The play action pass, the initial read right there was actually to Tavon Smith on a go route down the field. And the secondary receiver was George Kittle, who catches the football. That's the decision making of C.J. Beathard. You don't have to go for the bundle if it's not there in the pre-designed play. Check it down to Kittle. Good decision, Beathard.
Now back to Kanziri, who's had two touchdown runs on his last two carries. This time he got stretched out by Michael Rose Ivy, forcing him into Byerson Cockrell for the tackle for loss.
We talked about what makes Iowa so good defensively. What makes Iowa so tough offensively is C.J. Beathard's decision making. And that's the difference between Nebraska offensively and that young man right there. Tommy Armstrong, he puts the ball in harm's way too often. C.J. Beathard makes great decisions. He doesn't put the ball up for grabs, and his offense benefits from it most of the time.
And if Beathard is going to throw the ball at any point, does Nebraska have what it takes to get a takeaway against this Iowa team? Beathard running out of room, tries to throw underneath for Smith, and he scooped it up off the deck. Right at the 46-yard line, it'll still be third down about 11 coming up here.
This is the protector play of those two runs that Kanziri has taken into the end zone. Now you boot off of that same design, and that was a tremendous catch by Tavon Smith right there. My good run plays have protector plays in the pass game. We run play action pass off of the good run design. Took two runs into the end zone, so we play action off of that same look.
Still third down and long here. Nebraska needs to get off the field if they want to stay in this game. Beathard with space. Getting close to the line of scrimmage, he throws a dangerous pass that was off the fingertips of Chris Jones. Fourth down and 11, and Nebraska indeed will get off the field.
Well, indeed, C.J. Beathard was dangerously close to being past the line of scrimmage. But remember, your entire body and ball have to be across the line of scrimmage, and the officials determined that this was a legal pass, but it still wasn't a very good decision out of C.J. Beathard.
Here's the punt from Kidd. Got the hang time he needed to pin Westerkamp at the 8-yard line. Another good job by Dylan Kidd, the senior. Say hello to our friend, the Duck.
Affleck.
Our Affleck trivia question. C.J. Beathard, only one of four Power 5 quarterbacks in the last 5 years to win each of their first 12 career starts. The other three are impressive. I'd be curious if any of you guys out there can get all three. It's our Affleck trivia question. We'll have the answer in a little bit. And now it's up to Tommy Armstrong. Long field. We've seen him have good drives and bad. His last drive on a long throw led to his third interception. Can the run game get going too? Here's Quas. He's tumbled down at the 11 by Faith Akakiti.
Adam, Nebraska does so many good things on the offensive side of the ball, but they also turn the ball over. 25 turnovers thus far, including the three interceptions today with Tommy Armstrong, and they were all three of the same variety. Very, very poor decision-making by the quarterback.
Minus two in takeaways today against Iowa, which has not lost the turnover battle since the first game of the season. They've been even or plus every game since. Armstrong slinging a screen pass for Lane Hovey. The Iowa Hawkeye fan growing up gets jarred out by Maben close to the sticks. Here are the Armstrong picks in this game. What do you see?
Yeah, and they were all drives that don't go in the end zone because of poor decisions. The footwork is bad. He's falling away from throws. Therefore, you can't get the right amount on it. And then he throws into harm's way. A post-route double coverage, you just simply can't go there. They're dead throws to begin with. There are check-down receivers on the field. Tommy Armstrong needs to find him here.
And they move the chains on third and short. It is Amani Quas lunging and pushing and seemingly having enough for the first down. We'll see. Looks like his body was well past it, and he does pick it up to keep this drive alive for Nebraska. That's all you want when you're inside your own 10. Get that first down.
Remember, Cross is 6'1", 230 pounds. There isn't a lot of penetration because Iowa isn't really that type of defense, and enough of a push, and then you send a big back up in there.
240-pounder out of Georgia. Saw a lot of time as a freshman when Rex Burkhead suffered an injury. He's been an important part of this Nebraska offense these last couple of years. He is forced inside by King, who grabs him after a pickup to the 22-yard line. There's a lot of adversity for this Nebraska team. That's been a theme for them all year. 21 different offensive starters, 20 different defensive starters, the close calls at the end of games, losing four times in the opponent's final possession, losing a bunch of close games. Going back to the Iowa game last year that they lost by three in overtime, their last eight losses have come by a combined 30 points. Incredible to have a stretch like that. That's less than 4 points of a margin in those losses. Jewel and King team up for the tackle at the 25-yard line, and it will be third down and about three as the third quarter comes to a close. Playoff hopes at stake for the fourth-ranked and unbeaten Big Ten West champion Iowa Hawkeyes. The Huskers need an upset to secure a pole berth.
In the third quarter, timeout on the field.
A lot of folks have their eyes on this game with good reason. An 11-point Iowa lead as we head to the fourth. ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, continues after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Question for the Iowa Hawkeyes is, are they in? ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, part of the rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. This is a great scene. The 347th consecutive sellout going back to 1962 at Memorial Stadium. Even Herky's getting into it. The Hawkeyes fourth ranked and unbeaten. Lost in overtime to Nebraska a year ago after the Huskers came back from down 17. Huskers need a win to get bowl eligible. They have third and four to start the fourth. And Stanley Morgan converts a first down to the 39-yard line. A true freshman dragging Greg Maben. Picks up 14 yards. The Hawkeyes have not trailed in the fourth quarter all season long. They haven't trailed in general in a game for 25 quarters. You got to go back to the Illinois game in the second quarter. The last time the Hawkeyes were trailing. Nearly 6.5 hours of game time they haven't trailed. First down, it's Cross to the 42.
Adam, don't you have the feeling that this is a very important drive to answer in this game? The way Iowa ran the football in that third quarter, and remember the first half, Iowa had 15 rushes for 52 yards, 3.5 a pop. Third quarter, four rushes, and they gashed them for 98 yards and two touchdowns.
Off play action. Armstrong with all day. And a deep shot downfield, and it is incomplete. Looking for Alonzo Moore, who had Maben in tight coverage, and it sets up third down and six.
Iowa does such a good job of getting fits on the back end in coverage. Maben is going to carry the vertical route down the field, and so many times Iowa is in the right place at the right time. They keep a top on the coverage typically. That's terrific coverage by Maben, and you can see Desmond King didn't have anyone to cover on his side with the two-man route. He was coming over the top to help as well.
Armstrong on third down, into a tight window, looking for Riley, and it was off the hands of Maben again. Miles Taylor was in on the coverage as well. There were a couple of Iowa bodies out there as Armstrong tried to drive one into traffic, and it's fourth down.
Yeah, and it was into traffic. Brandon Riley actually goes down running his curl route right there, but it wasn't very well ran, and it was really well defended. The trifecta right there surrounding Brandon Riley. The coverage between Miles Taylor and Maben as well from his corner position.
Here is King back to return this Sam Fultz punt. Sam Fultz, the Big Ten's top punter, pins Iowa deep, a long field in front of the Hawkeyes, unbeaten, leading by 11 in the fourth. And now the answer to today's
Aflac
trivia question. Iowa C.J. Beathard, one of only four Power 5 QBs in the last 5 years to start their career 12-0. Who are the other three? Pretty good company to be a part of. A couple of Heisman winners and BCS champions. And a guy who was pretty good. He lost to Cam Newton in the BCS title game in Darren Thomas. Of course, Jameis Winston did not lose until the semifinal game against Oregon in the first college football playoff. That's our Aflac trivia question answer. Long field in front of the Hawkeyes, and it's Lott and Lincoln again. Kanziri. Tackle is there. Along with Dedrick Young. Team up for a tackle right at the line of scrimmage. 14 plays on 7 third quarter snaps for the Hawkeye offense.
Jordan Kanziri, 29 yards for a touchdown and 68 for a touchdown. Yeah. Doesn't take many plays when you're going off tackle in your stretch game. Led by the fullback, and then Kanziri takes it to the house.
14 quick points on those kids. Here he carries. He's the tail of the tandem here. And Kanziri, good maintenance play on second down to set up third down and about three.
We hadn't seen Iowa been all that successful in the entire first half on what they call their stretch play. And what they're doing is they run inside zone, but they also stretch it and try to get outside this kind of on the edge in that C gap. They lead with the fullback, and then Kinzeri mushes it up in behind them. That time it was right back inside once again when they needed to kind of a maintenance play, like you said, Adam.
How about that? 0 for 6 on third down. Iowa was 60%. 15 for its last 25 in this recent stretch. Can Kanziri do it? He cannot. He got dropped at the 15-yard line, and it's going to end up being fourth down in about a yard. And with 12 minutes to play and still a two-score game, Nebraska is going to force a three and out. Huge stand by the Husker D.
Yeah, I'm with you. I really thought that stand by Nebraska's defense was kind of an all or nothing situation right now, the way Iowa has been running the football and up by 11 points at this point in time.
Again, Huskers came back from a three-score deficit last year on the road. Second time that they've trailed by 11 here today. Kinn, again, decent enough hang time to force Westerkamp into one spot. But they'll start this drive in plus territory. Well, huge Big Ten games on Saturday. First on ABC at noon Eastern time. Number 8, Ohio State. Number 10, Michigan. Then on ESPN at 3:30 Eastern time, Penn State and number 5, Michigan State. Huge doubleheader, part of our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. If Michigan State wins, that's it. They're in to face Iowa in the Big Ten championship game. If Michigan State loses their game, whoever wins the Michigan-Ohio State game will play Iowa. Iowa is at least a 60% underdog, according to the FPI, against all three opponents. Michigan State, their easiest quote-unquote opponent. And first down here is Kwas. Solid run and keeps moving. Excellent run. Works all the way down to the 41. Mind you that Iowa played a team in Pitt, led by Pat Narduzzi earlier this year, the head coach. A very similar scheme to what Michigan State runs on defense. Of course, Iowa, one of their key wins was against Pittsburgh this year. From behind by Nathan Budgeta.
And if you're Iowa defensively, that's certainly what you want Cross doing, trying to bounce him outside, and he's not your speed back. He will be a pile mover between the box, but it's Newbie that has more quickness and speed outside. That isn't Cross's strong suit right there.
Third down and 3. Nebraska does not want to waste this field position. You wonder if this is four down territory.
I think it has to be, no doubt about it.
Look at this. A little design run for Armstrong, and he gets stacked up. There is a penalty marker thrown on the play.
I think Ryan Reeves, the center, is going to get called for holding, and then I think a flag came in late.
It did, Cal. Maybe in a little bit of the skirmish, verbal or physical or otherwise,
maybe
at the end
both.
Of that play, yeah. Lomax, you saw Armstrong kind of chopping up in that pile.
I think there's a hold inside by Ryan Reeves, which is the first flag, and anyone's guess outside. There was a whole lot going on out on the edge.
Yeah, that second flag could have a major impact on whether
no
or
doubt.
Not Nebraska gets to move deeper into territory of Iowa here. Ron Snodgrass, our lead official.
And did the second one come after
the
play?
There's no foul at the end of the play.
Wow.
Holding offense number 65.
Yeah, you nailed it, Kel. Reeves on the hold.
10-yard penalty. Repeat, third down.
So again, they'll pick up the late flag. No personal foul or anything of that nature at the end.
Ryan Reeves right there in the middle, and you can see he gets the right hand and Poles budgeted down a little bit. And then out on the edge was apparently a personal foul initially, but it was picked up late.
Just kind of a quick skirmish there. I wonder if the hand of the Kakatee was part of that, or if potentially even Parker Hesse was trying to make sure he didn't do anything wrong. Ends up being third down and 13 on the eighth Nebraska penalty accepted today. Armstrong for Moore right near the sticks. Did he hold on? He did. Where will they spot this football? The 38-yard line was the line to gain, and Moore made the catch. Where will they spot it? And now, is Alonzo Moore okay, is the other question.
And Maven, Greg Maven on the coverage, but this was a scene.
Going on the field is a completed catch for a first down.
That was a BB right there by Tommy Armstrong. Very well thrown. Our yellow line right there is usually pretty accurate, and they move the chains.
How about that?
Third and 13. That was desperately needed, to say the least.
And how about this? If Iowa had declined that holding penalty, it would have been fourth and three. Might have been four down territory. They had to accept it just in case Nebraska wanted to go for it on fourth down. So on third and 13, Armstrong moves the chains. However, that may be in question.
Rolling on the field was a completed catch. Play is under further review.
So Tom Fiedler is going to have a crucial call for you on the other side of this break with 9:16 to play. Ron Snodgrass, our lead official, let us know that the call stood. The Alonzo Moore reception right dead center at the 38-yard line. The line to gain to move the chains. His knees down right when he makes the catch. So wherever he had possession of the football, that's where the ball should be spotted. The line to gain was at the 38-yard line of the replay booth, led by Tom Fiedler, ruled that there was no indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field, which was a first down catch at the 38-yard line. You can review a spot when it relates to a first down or a score, so that was reviewable, and not enough, or I should say, no indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. So first down at the 38-yard line for the Huskers, trailing by 11. Armstrong on the slant. This is Jamal Turner, and he's close to the sticks at the 28-yard line. 10 yards to move the chains. Miles Taylor stopped him right there, and it's first down.
Armstrong has such arm talent. That's why he is successful plenty of times when his feet are completely almost perpendicular to his target, which happens quite often, but it's the exact same thing that also gets him into trouble. That is something that Mike Riley and Danny Langsdorf is going to work with him on in the spring and summer.
Another play fake. Armstrong spinning to extend the play, and he got pushed from behind by Parker Hesse, and that threw him off target just enough as he was tiptoeing the sidelines. He's out at the 23 on a run of five.
See, Adam, what you want to do if you're Mike Riley and Danny Langsdorf, the offensive play caller for Nebraska, is you want to marry those two things together. You know, impromptu stuff that we just saw, which is exceptional, but you also want sound fundamentals, because fundamentals in throwing lead to accuracy down the field.
Surging forward and very close to the 18-yard line. Parker Hesse off the edge. They brought Matt Nelson into the game. The Iowa Hawkeye defense did. The redshirt freshman, 96 in white. Nate Meyer, the senior, is not currently on the field right now. So off the edges, Iowa has two freshmen in Hesse and Nelson playing on crucial plays on the defensive end, and a crucial third and one here. Is this going to be another Armstrong run? It'll be a track play, trying to run it up the middle, and Bo Bauer was there to stop him on. He crossed shy of the line to gain. Based on where the line judge came out, it's going to be a yard short. And now it's fourth down and one with 7 minutes to go. A field goal makes it a one-score game here.
Absolutely no push up front. And I thought a quarterback sneak actually to the left side. There's a bubble in the under defense that Iowa runs in their front, and there was softness to the left on a quarterback sneak.
Armstrong in the shotgun on fourth and one as the Hawkeyes load the line. They're going to go for it here. Armstrong to the end zone for Riley, and it's incomplete. Greg Maven in coverage, and it's a turnover on downs. They could have gone for the field goal, which would have made it a one-possession game. Instead, they throw a fade on fourth and one from the gun.
I think it's a dreadful play call to start with. You can see the fade route right there in Riley, and Maven has good coverage, but a very low percentage play. I don't agree with that call whatsoever.
ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers, on the Dr. Pepper Championship Drive Game of the Week. Hawkeyes get the football back after Mike Riley and Danny Langsdorf opt to go with a fade pass out of the shotgun on fourth down and one. A low percentage play. Maven had good coverage, and the Hawkeyes were unbeaten with a Big Ten championship game date next week in Indianapolis, and an eye towards the college football playoff. Are up two scores with 6:35 to play. Jordan Kanziri has been a big reason why this Hawkeye team has an 11-point lead currently, as we take a look at the bright side brought to you by CarMax. He's looked very good, gradually better since coming back from the ankle. He's got two touchdowns today.
And I think Iowa's best all-around back, and the two long touchdown runs in this second half obviously are the difference in this game. But he's had himself a great afternoon, but that last series in play calling for Nebraska is befuddling to me. Why not kick a field goal, make it an 8-point game, and hope you get the ball back? I don't understand that at all.
That would have been about a 36-yard field goal here. Beathard, a bit of a broken play as Josh Kalu came off the edge from the cornerback spot and has the sack, the first of his season on Beathard, who is kind of twisting one way and turning the other.
And this was a broken play. The ball handling just wasn't there, and I think Kanziri was going right at his quarterback. The mesh point certainly wasn't in sync, but how about this third and 14 if it was a 20-28 game as opposed to 28-17, if Nebraska would have kicked a field goal? And then if you're going for it on fourth down, first of all, throw that play, the fade on third down, if you want to do that at all. The quarterback sneak was the best play right there. I don't understand that. You go for a low percentage 50-50 ball outside on fourth and one. Wow.
Iowa's going to take a third and 14 on what feels like a do-or-die play on both sides right now. Told you, it felt like a do-or-die play for both sides right now. Iowa converts third down and 14, and they have a chance to salt away an 11-point lead and move to 12-0 for the first time in program history. But they have not been able to convert a third down today, and it is third and long. Nebraska needs a stop to keep this game alive for them right now. Gregor Koble, part of that set, for the tunnel screen for Vandenberg, and he got chased down from behind, well shy of the line to gain. Valentine was there, redshirt junior, and Josh Kalu helped team him up. With 5 minutes to play, Nebraska will get the ball back. They have all three of their timeouts, but time is becoming a factor.
Yeah, no question about it. Time is becoming a factor. I don't mind not calling a timeout right here. You keep them in your pocket. They'll have well over 4 minutes by the time they get this ball back again.
Dylan Kidd has been averaging 43 on the season. He's gone shorter with higher hang times in this game to prevent any returns. Westerkamp again will signal fair catch, but they've got the ball right at midfield. Good field position with 4:27 to play as we check in with John Saunders.
All right, thanks a lot. We're going to update a few things for you and get you ready for tonight. Miles Gaskin here from just 5 yards out comes out of a crowd and piles his way into the end zone. Washington reeling over Washington State 38-10. You can see Oregon is cruising as well. And Chris Johnson is going to make his first career start of the game as Baylor gets ready to face TCU. Johnson, of course, now the third quarterback coming in for the Bears. That's coming up on ESPN tonight.
John, thanks very much. Armstrong on first down, throws an interception, and it's Josie Jewell. Second career interception for Jewell, and that might just be enough to put this game away with 4:14 to play. Fourth pick for Tommy Armstrong.
And a flag comes in real late. There was some activity after that play, but one more really poor interception. Josie Jewell just drops back into his zone, and lo and behold, the ball hits him right in the chest.
After the play, personal foul, late hit on the intercepting team, number 14. 15-yard penalty, first down, Iowa.
First four interception game of Tommy Armstrong's career.
Yeah, and he just doesn't act like he saw this very clearly, and Jewell is going to be right here, and he's simply going to drop into the zone, make eye contact with the quarterback, and look for the football right there. You can see Jewell looks up the route to some extent, was a dig route, Westerkamp right behind him on the in route, and then it's a penalty late.
On King, 14 right there, knocking down.
Wow.
Terrell Newby after the play. So here is Kanziri as we approach 4 minutes to play. You heard John Saunders talk about it a moment ago. Huge game of the Big 12 tonight. It will be Chris Johnson, who is an outstanding dual threat quarterback coming out of high school. He's going to make his first career start as Jarrett Stidham is now done with a broken ankle. We'll see the quarterback situation for TCU. And how about Oklahoma State? Mason Rudolph has been dealing with a foot injury. You saw Samaje Perine, the outstanding Oklahoma running back. He's got a bit of an ankle issue. It's been a bang-em-up Big 12 season. We've got two huge games. Baylor-TCU on ESPN tonight and Bedlam on ABC tomorrow night. Part of our rivalry series presented by Jiffy Lube. Here's Kanziri, stacked up at the line of scrimmage. The third down coming up here is Josh Banderas on the stop, and now Nebraska will use one of those timeouts. Nebraska will need a stop here and would get the ball back more than likely with one timeout left. We gave you the Big 12 slate tonight and tomorrow. This is just the Big 12 scenarios for those of you curious, because there is still a lot to play for the Baylor Bears. They need to win tonight and next week at Texas and hope that Oklahoma State will beat Oklahoma tomorrow night, because Baylor has the tiebreaker on the Cowboys after their win in Stillwater last week. Oklahoma can make it all a moot point with a win tomorrow night on the road.
And I think Oklahoma is the best all-around team in that conference currently, and one of the top four teams, no doubt about it. Playing really good defense in a conference that isn't known for that. But Baylor certainly needs some help, but they're still in the middle of things.
Third down and 8 here for Iowa. It'll be a pass play. Beathard is able to get a completion to Pleva. That'll keep the clock moving, and at the very least force Nebraska to use a timeout on the 12th career catch for the redshirt senior out of Wisconsin. 3:17 to play, and Nebraska uses that second timeout. This is what's at stake. Playoff positioning, obviously. Iowa, you could have the debate if you want to, if they had lost this game.
The debate.
They were not thinking about that at all, and if you credit Kirk Ferentz for anything, it's being a guy who's going to champion the correct cliche, let's take it one game at a time. And certainly a win today and a win next week removes any doubt. Nebraska, meanwhile, needed a win to become bowl eligible only twice since 1962, had they missed the postseason in 04 and 07 under Bill Callahan. Now, they don't necessarily miss out on the postseason. If they are 5-7, there are a lot of bowl slots to fill, and the NCAA still hasn't locked down its process on what they're going to do if they don't have enough 6-win teams to send to a bowl game. So Nebraska is not out of the postseason, but they needed a win today to guarantee themselves a bowl berth. Again, Kidd has been keeping it high, and Westerkamp hasn't had much of a shot at a return. His longest career return is just 24 yards on a punt. This is where they missed DeMornay Pearson-El. Got an Iowa timeout.
Timeout. Iowa, their second, 30-second timeout.
And Adam, predicting Iowa into the playoffs potentially and under the national stage regardless, it's interesting that people can't seem to accept this team right here. The record 11-0, they're on their way to be 12-0, and the quality wins you can see with Wisconsin and Northwestern, Pitt. Strength of record is fifth. They're going to play a really good team in the Big Ten championship game. And to me, what's intriguing is the way they play the game. It's a complete team, team defense, team offense. They run it. They defend the run. They don't take it away. All of those type of things are really good football. And I think that plays well matchup wise with whoever they see down the road.
No possible return here for Westerkamp. Near the 20-yard line is where Nebraska will have it with 3:10 to play and one timeout remaining on a very cold and chilly night here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Game control is something that stuck out to me on that graphic for Iowa as well, because they're top 10 in the country. For the most part this year, they have been in control of games compared to a top 25 team or an average top 25 team against the same schedule.
We thought coming into this game that these teams were actually pretty evenly matched. It was about Armstrong's decision making. The four interceptions really are the difference right now in this game.
They had three against Rutgers a couple of weeks ago, along with three touchdown passes. That one nearly picked up by Desmond King, which would have given him the new Iowa record. He's got eight this season.
And that was intended to Stanley Morgan, and the receiver just falls down right here. And King usually has great ball skills and hangs on to passes like that, and that could have been number five. But I thought the decision making of Tommy Armstrong in this game was going to be the difference, and that's exactly how this one has played out.
That one batted into the air by the redshirt freshman Matt Nelson. Make that, I'm sorry, 99. That's my apologies. Nathan Budgetta, the redshirt sophomore. Budget up the middle, and we've seen that more than once in this ball game today.
And some of that happens. You see Budget right there. Some of that happens. Watch how Tommy Armstrong is falling away from this throw. He's literally stepping backwards with his left foot when he throws that. It's a short pass, but sometimes you can't get around traffic when your footwork isn't sound.
Third down to 10. And a little screen here on the check down for Terrell Newby. Run out by Fisher, who has had a very good game today. It'll be fourth down for the Cornhuskers with 2:54 remaining.
And whoever Iowa plays down the road in that Big Ten championship game and then maybe into the playoffs, you're going to have to beat a team in Iowa that doesn't beat themselves. They're ultra efficient offensively. They force you to play that way because of the way their defense plays as well. They're going to be a tough out.
Morgan makes the catch on fourth down, so Nebraska is still alive. They'll have the ball at the 35-yard line with 2:29 to play. Clock will stop to move the chains. And again, only one timeout remaining for the Huskers.
One big play away from an onside kick.
They're going to need a big play here. Armstrong for Riley. Threw behind him, and somehow Brandon Riley reaching back made the catch for a first down across the 45. It's a heck of a play by Riley.
Yeah, this is a tremendous catch of a ball thrown behind him by about 2 feet, and Riley reaches back and snatches it.
Approaching 2 minutes to play. Armstrong, too much heat on that one for Lane Hovey.
Footwork. Most of the time when there's an errant pass down the field, you can trace it right to the footwork of the quarterback, and you can on that play right there.
You mentioned it, Kel. They're going to have some time with Tommy Armstrong, Will, Mike Riley and Danny Langsdorf in the offseason to try to work on some of those mechanical things. Danny Langsdorf had some good NFL experience with Eli Manning last year. Looking for the Giants. Newby will step out of bounds with 2:01 to play. That'll be enough to move the chains to the 42-yard line. Again, because he stepped out at 2:01, the clock begins on the referee's whistle. Had he stepped out at 2 minutes, Or actually, it should be 159 had he stepped out at 159. Then they would have stopped the clock. Armstrong back to Morgan with the corner blitz coming. And Morgan dragged down by Desmond King. Out of bounds, and that will stop the clock with a minute 40 to play.
Maybe we threw dirt on this one just a little bit too early, because this gets into the end zone and we're an onside kick away from this becoming quite interesting.
Now Iowa's going to use their timeout.
Timeout, Iowa. Their third and final timeout. This will be a 30-second timeout.
Without harping on it too much, Kelly, you still go back to 7 minutes to go in this game.
I think it deserves to be harped on.
You know, they had an opportunity here. This is third down and one. Can't move the chain. So it's fourth down and one from about the 19-yard line. And they go out of the shotgun and throw a fade to Riley with a really good cornerback in Maven in coverage. And instead of either A, going for a short yardage run on fourth and one, or going for about what would be a 35, 36-yard field goal with the wind, opted to go for that play call, and it could have been 28-20. Not to say that the kick would have been guaranteed. Not to say they were guaranteed to convert a fourth and one.
There's no excuse for it, but it's a bottom line.
That play call felt wrong at the
end. Yeah, there's no doubt about it.
So now it's first and 10 at the 24-yard line, a minute 40 to go. One timeout still left. Iowa's going with that Raider defense. Nobody with their hand out. Armstrong running out of time, and he got it past the line of scrimmage with Aaron Menz chasing him down, the redshirt freshman out of Kansas City.
Yeah, good decision. Very well covered on the back end by Iowa. That's what Armstrong needs to learn. Keep the play alive by extending it with your feet, but at the end, finish it with a good decision. Throwing the ball away right there was the perfect decision for Armstrong.
Just three again. Armstrong to the sideline, and it is incomplete for Sam Cotton. The third brother to play at Nebraska, Jake and Ben, his brothers.
And Cotton is typically the inline tight end that doesn't run a lot of routes and catch a lot of passes, but he should have probably had that one. That was pretty well thrown on the corner route to Sam Cotton.
Two plays to keep this drive alive for the Huskers with a minute 26 left. A spy coverage on Armstrong here, and Westerkamp was the closest man to it, but didn't really look like he was throwing to Westerkamp in the route. Now it's fourth down and 10.
Now Nebraska seems to be content with going for the field goal right here.
You got to make it a one-score game in one way or another. So this would make it an 8-point, one-score game. Brown has been fantastic, especially in the second half of the year. He's made each of his last 9 field goals. 8 of them have been from 40 yards or more. This 42 with the wind. And the Huskers are not done yet. Makes it a one-score game, and now it's up to the onside kick.
That was very well managed. That's the way the previous drive should have ended, quite frankly, and we would be talking about something completely different. Mike Riley does get to the onside kick opportunity that they need to recover right here, but
I'm going to need to convert something big here on that onside kick. Again, playoff positioning, for those of you who haven't been able to watch over the course of the afternoon, Iowa number 4 in the college football playoff rankings. A win would give them their first 12-win season in school history, a historic run. They've won a Big Ten West championship. They will play in the Big Ten title game against either Michigan State, Michigan, or Ohio State tomorrow. Nebraska needed a win to be bowl eligible. They have reached the postseason 44 of the last 46 years. Onside kick time. Nebraska is 1-for-3 on onside kicks this season. Iowa has not allowed an onside kick this season in 3 attempts. They've been able to recover all 3 attempts against them this year. A Hawkeye team that has not trailed in the fourth quarter all season long. Couple of receivers out there up front for Iowa. And here is the onside kick, and it is grabbed by the tight end, Henry Krieger Coble, and the Iowa Hawkeyes are going to go to 12-0. A 12-win season for the first time in program history, with a date in the Big Ten championship game and essentially a play-in for the college football playoff.
And the country has gotten a good view of why Iowa is so tough, and this takes the right hop to Krieger Coble, and does the right thing and jumps on it, secures it, gets on the ground. But Iowa's going to be a tough out because they simply don't make a lot of mistakes. They don't beat themselves. They defend the run. They run it well. They like the football, the value of it. They don't make a lot of mistakes as far as putting the ball in harm's way. What they do travels really well and will match up really well against whoever they play.
Iowa's going to win this game, Kelly, without converting a third down. 0-for-8 on the day.
You can get away with things like that, Adam, if you do so many of the other things well. They were so good on first down. They were +3 in the turnover takeaway today, and that's how they win games.
Yes.
They limit explosives. They're efficient. They win the turnover takeaway battle. All of those things, you can afford to have hiccups on third down once in a while. They converted 47% of the time coming into today, and they just won this game simply in other ways.
One more will do it. And the Iowa Hawkeyes are off to the Big Ten championship game with an unblemished record. Call it what you want, but it is a play-in game for the Hawkeyes in Indianapolis at Lucas Oil Stadium next week. They win, you got to put them into the college football playoff. What a run by the Iowa Hawkeyes in the first meeting in Big Ten play between Kirk Ferentz and Mike Riley. And the Heroes Trophy belongs to Iowa in the fifth meeting as Big Ten foes. Kirk Ferentz, his team's 12-0, and he is with Olivia Harlan.
The first undefeated regular season in Hawkeye history. Coach, I know how much you like this team. What makes them different?
Yeah, you know, they play hard. That's, I said, only, I don't know how good we are, but they play hard. They play together. It's just a lot of fun to be with every day.
I've got to ask, now that it's come, are you surprised?
You know, I don't know. Surprise is the right word. We've looked at it 1 week at a time. And we just try to, you know, prepare and play our best on Saturday. And this is a Friday game, obviously. But these guys have handled it week by week. And, you know, you start stacking them up, good things happen.
Week by week, you're not done yet. Big Ten championship coming up with three potential candidates. How do you keep the momentum going?
Well, I don't know. We want to enjoy this one. You know, the one nice thing about playing Friday, they got all day tonight and they got all day tomorrow. Sunday, we'll figure out what we're going to do the next week. But these guys have really worked hard. They certainly deserve to enjoy this a little bit.
Congratulations. Go celebrate.
Thanks,
with your
Lydia.
Team.
Thank you.
Michigan State, Michigan, or Ohio State. If the Spartans beat Penn State tomorrow, they'll play the Hawkeyes in the Big Ten title game. If Michigan State loses their game, whoever wins the earlier matchup between Ohio State and Michigan will move on to the Big Ten championship game. That's all from Lincoln, Nebraska. The Hawkeyes are undefeated, 12-0, on their way to Indianapolis with a potential shot at the college football playoff. Final score 28-20. Reminder that tomorrow, the game, Ohio State, Michigan, noon Eastern on ABC. For Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan, our amazing, wonderful crew, Adam Amin, thanks so much.